Somebody give the Lord a big shout.
Hallelujah.
Father, we give you praise tonight. We ask for the Spirit of God to be present, to anoint our ears to hear. And tonight we can renew our minds, that we may gain an understanding of the vital parts of responsibility that we should have in living long and finishing strong. And Lord, we give you praise for it now. Holy Spirit, you are welcome to move up and down every aisle. And we just give you praise. Thank you so much for this day. Thank you for tomorrow that we've not seen yet, Lord. And we plead the blood of Jesus on every situation that's represented here tonight. And we thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Well, turn and greet two or three of your neighbors and you can take your seats tonight. Amen. Tonight, we begin a special two-night conference. And I thought, you know, we're always having a healing conference. Well, what would happen if we could get a hold of how to be healthy? And you know, the Bible says in very clearly in Revelations that Jesus has the keys of death and the grave. And he has the keys, and he will only use those keys towards our favor. But now, we have to accept the responsibility for walking in health. That's got to be your responsibility. That's not your doctor's responsibility. That's your responsibility. And I just thought, you know, that there are a lot of things people don't know. You've heard me say it often, you can't do better until you know better. Amen. And you know, if you're talking about living 80, 90, 100 years, you're going to have to know some things about how to take care of your physical body. You know, recently I had the privilege of being a part of a seminar where they've been doing some work on trying to prevent the growth of cancer by eating certain foods. And there are five types of food that you can eat if you eat them often enough that would really help you out. I mean, it's an amazing thing, and we'll cover it sometime throughout this next 2 days. But I want to make sure everybody have a pad. Have a pen. You know, somebody said, well, I want me some revelation. Well, get some revelation of how to be healthy. Okay? Some people, they, you know, so spiritual, and it's good to be spiritual, you know, but you got to learn how to live on the earth, and you got to learn how to exist. Our guest tonight, the first time, he just really blew my mind. I interviewed him when we were doing some taping for a talk show that I thought I was going to do nationally, and thank God he woke me up before I went out there and did that and hurt myself. But he began to reveal some things to me. And I had a medical doctor on the set, and I had he just dealt with medicine, and Dr. Joel Wallach goes so much more than that. And I mean, he put the guy on the spot, and the guy was real honest. He says, we know medicine, but we don't know too much about health. And ladies and gentlemen, I try to bring you the best. I try to bring you the best. Amen. Dr. Joel Wallach's work has resulted in the publication of more than 70 peer review and referred journal articles in the fields of nutrition and pharmaceutical research. He promotes worldwide health, beauty, and youthful energy. And for more than 40 years, it has been Dr. Wallach's mission to bring accurate and timely health information to the world. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to stand to your feet and welcome our speaker for the next couple of nights as he takes us on a journey to achieving the health that we want. Please welcome Dr. Joel Wallach as he comes at this time.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you so much, Pastor Dollar and Pastor Taffy. They're just so wonderful. Please, please have a seat. And really appreciate the opportunity to share with you tonight. And I was so glad to hear Pastor Dollar said that we ourselves have responsibility. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight and tomorrow. Tonight we're going to talk about basically the scorecard of what we've been doing and how well or how badly we've been doing it. And then tomorrow we're going to talk about five or six major diseases and how we can prevent them and how we can reverse them. I believe that the World Changers Church family can be the first church family in the world to be disease-free. Amen. 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 Because you have a leader who has that belief. I think he's a personally chosen by God. I really do. But Pastor Dollar is just so wonderful. Amen? Amen. Okay. Okay. So we're going to get started, and if we could have the first slide. And basically what I'm going to share with you is so outrageous, I chose to have some references that you could recognize, Time Magazine, Newsweek Magazine, Forbes Magazine, big newspapers, because everything that I'm going to share with you has been published in these newspapers, and you're going to say, oh, come on, that can't be real. And so we could have those slides, I'd be grateful. There we go. Okay, let's start with this. When Jesus came to Jerusalem, what a thing that was. That was like a hero's welcome for a carpenter, the Son of God, right? He didn't have permission from any government. He didn't have permission. This was the people who welcomed him. And so you don't have to have permission from a doctor. You don't have to have permission from any government to be healthful. You can take responsibility and do that yourself because God's given you permission. Actually, he gave you an instruction. He gave you an order. In the Old Testament, right in Genesis, he said, and man's year shall be 120, right? 120 years. If we fall short of that, we haven't followed his command. And God made us in his image, didn't he? It says so right in the Bible, so we got to believe it, right? It says so that God made us in his image, and God doesn't have diabetes and high blood pressure and arthritis and Alzheimer's disease and obesity and hemorrhoids. And so we have to, you know, say, okay, we must be doing something wrong here, because if we're made in his image, then we got to do a little better here. And so if we go to the next slide, I'd be grateful. I'm going to kind of whip through these. Well, this is just sort of a Time Magazine, December of 2008, and it said that we're going to take the pulse of America here, and by golly, we're not doing very well, and our kids aren't going to do as well as we're doing. There's a real problem with our health. Even though we're spending more money than all the other 218 nations in the world put together, we're not doing very well. So let's go on. Let's go to the next slide. Whoop, we went a little fast there. There we go. And one of God's favorite people were kids. And so one of the things that Jesus did was work with kids all the time. He said, bring me the children, right? Didn't he? And that's where we're going to have to start, because people who are our age and older oftentimes have a belief system that believes whatever the medical system, whatever the pharmaceutical industry says, and that has led us into the problems we have. And as a result, we have to kind of begin to work with the kids and teach them about health. We have to teach the kids about health. So then when they're adults, be healthy. It's kind of late when somebody's dying of 18 diseases to say, okay, let's fix you with an herb. That's not going to be a struggle, okay? And so we have to start with kids with lifestyle and diet and vitamins and minerals, and we'll talk about that in some detail. So let's go on to the next one, please. And let's go on to the next one. Okay, here we go. In 1990, we ranked 17th in longevity. There are 16 other countries whose peoples live longer than us. So let's go on to the next one. In 2000, 10 years later, we ranked 24th. That's going the wrong direction, isn't it? Okay, let's go to the next one. In 2005, 5 years later, 15 years after 1990, we ranked 46th in longevity. You know, my grandkids would say, Grandpa, our healthcare system sucks. Okay, it's not real good. You wouldn't tolerate that in any other industry. Remember, we're spending more money for healthcare than all the other 218 nations in the world put together. And in 15 years, we dropped from 17th down to 46th. Why aren't we banging on the doors and saying, hey, we want our money back? we're not getting the bang for the buck here. We're not getting the service that we paid for. Let's go to the next one. Now, this one will make you cry. This was a full-page story in the USA Today back in February of 2007, 3.5 years ago, a little over 3.5 years ago. And the data that I'm going to share with you was put in that issue of USA Today. It came from the Centers for Disease Control right out of Atlanta here, this federal agency that tracks disease, who gets what disease, percentages of those will die, and so on. And then they also got it from the Journal of the American Medical Association, the Journal of the Medical Association in America, the most prestigious medical journal in the world. And up in that upper left-hand corner, kind of the third little half paragraph down, it says, the medical system in America, medical doctors in America, each year have killed, injured, and infected 15 million of their customers in their workplace every year. They don't even get an OSHA ticket. Medical doctors each year kill, injure, and infect 15 million people in their workplace. They don't even get an OSHA ticket. I want you to think about it. Over the past 5 years, Toyota, with a little rubber mat under the gas pill, killed 60, you know, about 12 a year for 5 years. And there's Senate investigations. There's billion-dollar lawsuits against Toyota by people who just looked at a Toyota and got ill just looking at one, right? And so why is it that people get all hung up about 60 people being killed over a five-year period by a rubber mat under the accelerator, which is partly the fault of the driver, right? Letting that gas pedal get stuck with a rubber mat. And here's one profession who kills, injures, and infects 15 million of their customers, aka patients, in their workplace every year, and they get a walk. Don't let them do that anymore. Get second opinions. Don't take their first advice to you. Get second and third opinion. That's fair, right? You have that option. You have that responsibility. Okay, let's go to the next one. About 35 years ago, when I started giving 300 free lectures a year, grannies and granddaddies would come up to me at the gates of the airport and say, well, they didn't know who I was. I'm wearing jeans and a t-shirt. And they say, you want to see the albums of my grandkids, my photos of my grandkids? Well, today, they say, you want to see my 27 prescription drugs? I said, well, don't you have grandkids you want to talk about? I said, well, you have six beautiful grandkids. Now, this one's for my thyroid, and this one's for my adrenal glands, and this one's for my heart, and this one's for my diabetes. They just go right into that. Next, please. Deaths by medication errors rising. This is from 2006. It says that 1.5 million people are killed and injured every year, right in America, from prescription drugs every year. 1.5 million. There's more people killed and injured by prescription drugs every year than there are street drugs. We need to take the war on drugs out of the street and put them in the doctor's office. Next. Forbes magazine. I thought this was really profound. This is back in 2004, I believe. And it says, pharma's new enemy. Just clean living. Just live clean and you won't need to take any prescriptions. What a concept. You know, God's advice, Jesus' advice is still good. Just live clean. You won't need prescriptions. That's kind of interesting, isn't it? And I'll tell you what that means in just a minute. The next one, please. Now, the science of living longer is becoming important here because we have 80 million baby boomers who have come along. And it's to your advantage to make sure that every one of these baby boomers lives to be 120. You don't want them to be sick and in a nursing home because you're going to have to pay for it. Okay, so here's 80 million people who need to be healthy. You don't want them being lame and halt and have diabetes and get their legs cut off and go blind and get Alzheimer's disease when they're 50, 60 years of age because you're going to have to pay for it. And so we'll talk about that in detail tomorrow. But 80 million baby boomers are coming along and we had better make sure that they're healthy. I'm sure that includes lots of you in this audience. There's probably lots of baby boomers. I'm looking at the ages in here. We can go to the next one, please. This is from the New England Centenarian Study. It's a Harvard Medical School. They did a great study, and every year they track how many 100-year-olds are in America. And right now they say we have 100-year-old in America per 10,000 of our population. Is that good or bad? We're going to find out if that's good or bad. We have 100-year-old per 10,000. That's according to Harvard Medical School. Next, please. And this is a fellow. This is a Greek legal immigrant from Greece. And in 1970, he was told by some medical doctors in Pennsylvania that he just had less than a year to live. He had his whole belly was full of cancer, and there was nothing they could do. But they wanted to try a new experimental drug for cancer. And he said, well, will this help me? And he said, no, we just want to see if it kills you or not. We need to know if it's safe. He said, well, I think I'll pass. And he goes back to Greece and he starts eating this seaweed that rolls up on the beach every morning and eating goat meat and goat butter like your granddaddies, my granddaddies used to do, and eat eggs and chickens like we're not supposed to do. And he turned 2009, he turned 102 and he's still laying brick and painting fences at 102. Hallelujah! Next, please. This old swamp rat here, George Francis, died at 112, illiterate. This is his daughter reading the newspaper to him. He survived 19 presidents. He lived through 19 presidents, none of whom lived to be 100. They were all lawyers, graduated from Harvard and Yale and maybe even University of Georgia Law School, all those presidents. None of them lived to be 100. They died of an average of like 75 to 80. And here's an illiterate swamp rat from the swamps, Louisiana. His mode of transportation was a John boat and a pole. No electricity, nothing out there, and he died at 112. And so when the newspapers and the media asked his daughter what was his secret, she said, well, he broke all the rules of healthy eating. He lived on a diet heavy in eggs and dairy and lard sandwiches. Now, if you grew up in the country like me, you know what a lard sandwich is. At the end of the month, you're real welcome. Okay, next. This gal here died at 124 back in 2003. And the interesting thing about it, her birth certificate said that she was born of African slaves. Her mom and daddy were slaves, and she died at 124. And it was proven by her birth certificate. Now you say, well, come on, a slave in El Salvador, what kind of birth certificate they have? Well, the Jesuits in 1521 established a Catholic mission there, and they've been running birth certificates in all the old Spanish colonies since 1521. And they did that so they could tax people, so not so you could trace your genealogy. So you got to believe those were accurate, right? Okay, let's go to the next one. Now, this one here, this gal, this is a birthday announcement. She turned 126, and she also was blessed by having birth certificates and baptismal records from the local Catholic church there in the little island of Dominica. And Elizabeth Israel, they said, well, what is your secret? Because she was still alive at 126. And she said, well, I grew up eating food that was fertilized without chemical fertilizer, grown without chemical fertilizer. Now, what do you think that her mother and her grandmother, as young women, and she is a young woman, used for fertilizer in their garden to feed their family? Well, they used wood ashes. If you lived out in the country, if you had a parent or a grandparent who lived out in the country and they had a wood stove, you always put the wood ashes in the garden. Well, wood ashes are not carbon. Wood ashes are actually the minerals that are left when you burn away the carbon in the wood, and the okra and the sweet potatoes and the onions and the garlic and the corn, tomatoes would all take up the minerals that these wood ashes contained in them, and then you would eat those plants and you get minerals in that fashion. So that's what she's talking about. Next, please. This fella here, Dunn Gifford was the guy who promoted the Mediterranean diet and olive oil and whole grains and that kind of stuff. You notice he died of a heart attack at age 71. Well, there's a clue. The average Italian lives to be 72, so olive oil and whole grains might not be the perfect diet. See, the Sardinians, next door to them, in that big island to the west of Italy, they live to be an average of 90, and they live on goat meat, goat milk, goat butter, and onions and stuff like that. They don't eat olive oil, and they laugh at the Italians. They live to be 90, the Italians live to be 72. I'm going to skip the olive oil. Okay, next. Let's look at billionaires. You know, your doctor will say, look, just don't take any vitamins and minerals because you can get everything you need from your foods. Raise your hand if you heard that or read that. You can just eat well, you get everything you need. Well, billionaires can afford to eat good, can't they? So you think, if that's true, there should be a certain percentage of billionaires live to be 100. Well, according to Forbes magazine, when they did a survey in 2004, they said, you know, we've looked, we can't find a billionaire who's ever lived to be 100. The average lifespan of a billionaire is 78. And the average lifespan of a falling down red wine drunk in Atlanta is 75. So you don't gain much health-wise by being a billionaire. Okay, let's go to the next one. Now, there's never been a Nobel Prize winner ever lived to be 100. My favorite, Albert Einstein, who said one of my favorite things is insanity is doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different outcome. And he died at 76 of something that a turkey wouldn't die from. He actually died of something that we got rid of in turkeys in 1947, ruptured aneurysms. He died of a ruptured aortic aneurysm, and it's caused by a simple deficiency of the mineral copper. Now, the first thing that you see on the outside when you have a copper deficiency is white, gray, and silver hair. And his doctor kind of missed that one. I see a lot of copper deficiency looking out here tonight. And then the next thing that happens is you get a breakdown of the elastic fibers in your body, and you begin to get wrinkles, and you look like you've been run over by a Hummer. Just like Albert Einstein. Now, if he were to go to a plastic surgeon, would that plastic surgeon give him Botox and a facelift, or would they give him copper? He'd give him Botox and a facelift, right? Now, the next thing that happens is when you get a breakdown of the elastic fibers in your body, you get a breakdown of the elastic fibers in your blood vessels, and you get spider veins and varicose veins and hemorrhoids, which are varicose veins in a funny place. And so whenever I look at Albert Einstein, I know that he had hemorrhoids. It's kind of funny. I can just picture that. And then you get a breakdown of the elastic fibers in your arteries, and you get aneurysms. And then you die. 250,000 Americans die every year from ruptured aneurysms. About 1 million who survive ruptured aneurysms are disabled as a result to one degree or another. And it's all simply just a copper deficiency. Why did we take care of turkeys in 1947? We're letting human beings suffer that unnecessarily. Let's go to the next one. This is a U.S. News and World Report, very respected magazine. This goes back to February of 2004. Who needs doctors? Your next doctor might not be a medical doctor, might not be an MD, and you may be better off. That's not me. People say, Wallach, why are you so rude? No, I'm just reading the front cover of U.S. News and World Report. Because in 2004, they knew there was a grave problem. We're spending all this money, more money than all the 218 nations the world put together, and we're moving the wrong direction. Let's go to the next one. The average lifespan of a medical doctor, according to their own research, which was published in 1999 in all medical journals, the average lifespan of the family practitioner and the primary care physician in America is 56. Why would you go to a group of people whose average lifespan is 56 to learn how to live to be 120? It doesn't compute with me. And they die from diabetes, cancer, heart disease, and stroke. Why would you go to a group of people whose average lifespan is 56 who die from all the things you don't want to get for advice on how to live a long, healthful life? Now, when you have an emergency, you fall off the roof, you get in a fire, and you have fourth-degree burns, and you have terrible fractures because of accidents and things, you need a doctor. You need to go to the emergency room. But when you have other diseases where a day or two doesn't matter what treatment you get, you might want to kind of look around a little bit, right? Okay, next. Now, everybody believes that exercise is good for you, right? I mean, everybody knows exercise. I mean, the government tells you this. Doctors tell you this. Universities tell you this. Everybody tells you, ministers tell you exercise is good for you. But with the exception of three black gentlemen from the old Negro Baseball League days, there's never been a professional athlete ever lived to be 100. The average lifespan of professional athletes is 62. The average lifespan of a professional couch potato is 75. You gain 3 years in longevity, 13 years. You gain 13 years, say my math, 13 years in longevity by not exercising. And I said, yes, okay. Now, but see, there's a little bit of a funny thing here. Exercise without supplementation to replace what you sweat out is dangerous. But if you replace what you're sweating out, you're okay. Now, you have to appreciate that sweat is not just water. When people say, hydrate, drink plenty of water when you exercise. On hot days when you're sweating, drink plenty of water. That's only 2% of what you need to do. Because sweat is not water. Sweat is a soup that contains all the nutrients circulating in your blood. And if you're just drinking water, oops, you're soon in the negative. Why do these $2 million a game professional athletes get Charlie horses, and they get cartilage problems and tendon problems and ligament problems? They have personal trainers, they have dietitians and nutritionists, and they have team doctors. And yet they're a mess. And they exercise, and they exercise, and they exercise. That's because they're sweating out all these nutrients. They're drinking water and sports drinks with two nutrients in it. Whoops. Okay, next. Well, the Journal of the American Medical Association, 1977, immediately endorsed Jim Fix's book, and became an instant bestseller, that previous slide you saw. And so they had to do their due diligence there, and they said, uh-oh, because 5 years after he wrote that book, he died at age 52 of a heart attack while he was running. Bam! He just dropped dead. Now, he was training for the Olympics, doing the marathon, and he just drops dead at 52. So the Journal of the American Medical Association did a study, and they said, oops, we chose wrong. Oh. Because when they investigate, they said, while running, a man's risk of heart attack death increases by 700%. While running, a man's risk of heart attack death increases by 700%. Now, that will only be true. That's what was written there. That was in Runner's World magazine. Now, that will only be true if you don't supplement with all the things you're sweating out. If you're supplement with all the things you can sweat out, you can exercise and be safe. Let's go to the next one. Let's go to the next one. Let's stop there. That's Reggie Lewis, captain of the Boston Celtics. 28 years old, collapsed during a playoff game with the Charlotte Hornets back then. What are they now? They're not the Hornets. Bobcats. Yeah, thank you. And they, he collapsed, and he was diagnosed quite correctly with the disease called cardiomyopathy heart disease, which is unknown to doctors. It's a simple deficiency of the trace mineral selenium. And so they gathered up the top 12 cardiologists in the whole world and said, look, we want you to replace Reggie's heart. We want you to give him a heart transplant so we can get him back out in the court. That was the goal. And so they got this dream team together, and 2 weeks while they were arguing who was going to be the chosen one, who was going to be the lead surgeon, who was going to be history, you know, famous, he collapses and dies from a second cardiomyopathy heart attack. Okay, now we can go to the next one. A year and a half later, the captain of the dream team of cardiology, one Dr. W. Thomas Nessa, who taught cardiology at Harvard Medical School, ran the Boston Marathon every year. He was the captain of the dream team of cardiologists who was trying to save Reggie Lewis. Bam! He drops dead at age 48 from the same thing, cardiomyopathy heart attack. Now, if he were my cardiologist, I don't have a cardiologist, but if he were my cardiologist and he said that salt was bad and he died at 48 of a heart attack, I'd go around town, I'd collect every salt shaker. I'd be packing salt in my ears. I'd be giving myself salt enemas. I'd be just putting under my arms and holding. I'd be tracking salt everywhere, right? If he said eggs were bad, I'd be eating 25 eggs a day. If he said exercise was good, I would lay in bed and I wouldn't even blink. I wouldn't do nothing that resembled motion. Okay, next, please. Now, with the information you're armed with now, this young woman here, Ronelda Pierce, got an academic and an athletic scholarship to Florida State University. She was 6'5", 19 years old. She could do the Air Jordan thing. She could do the air walk, you know, and slam dunk a ball. The WNBA was already putting millions and millions of dollars of endorsement money into a fund for her and begging her not to go to college. She said, I'm going to get my degree. And halfway through her freshman year, a day after finishing a weekend game, she drops dead at age 19 of a ruptured aortic aneurysm, just like Albert Einstein. What did she die from? A copper deficiency. A copper deficiency. And she had team doctors and team nutritionists, and she had personal trainers, but she didn't have the raw materials that her body needed. Okay, next, please. Now, Theo Ratliff, he's one of the guys here from Atlanta, played for the Atlanta Hawks. His personal career was over 10 years ago when I first met him. He had bone-to-bone arthritis at 28 years old. He had bone-to-bone arthritis in both knees. He actually had cartilage popped off his hip, and he caught a ball during a game and fractured his wrist. To make a long story short, I rebuilt him 8 years ago, and he's made $140 million since his career was over. Just with vitamins and minerals, no joint replacements. Remember Bo Jackson? He chose poorly. He had double knee replacements, or double hip replacements, I guess it was. Now everybody says, Bo who? But see, Theo, this is his 16th year in the NBA. The longest running NBA player ever. And he is so old and decrepit at 38 years of age that the LA Lakers just drafted him. Okay, next, please. Now, God tells us to live to be 120. And what my wife and I did 10 years ago was begin to track the top 10 top 20 longevity cultures on earth, the top 20 longevity cultures on earth. We looked at all the common threads, things that they all did. Now, number one, they had 100-year-old per 250 of their population. They had 100-year-old per 250. We have 100-year-old per 10,000. We're not doing very good. Now, the nice thing about these top 20 cultures who live the longest, these people are all third world cultures. They don't have doctors. They don't have private and government insurance. They don't have hospitals and clinics. They don't have pharmacies or pharmaceuticals. They have no drive-thrus for fried foods because they don't have roads. They don't do anything bad because nobody's going to go there to sell them anything bad. They're third world cultures. But what they do, like that one gal, Elizabeth Israel, who's 26 years old, putting those wood ashes in her garden, they don't have any electricity, so they're still putting, every one of those top 20 longevity cultures or third world cultures, no electricity, they're still putting wood ashes in their gardens. They're still putting minerals in their food. Now, how many ever heard of Jesus? Raise your hand. Praise God. Everybody here has heard of Jesus. Praise God. Well, you know, when he was hidden, when the angel came down and told Joseph, you better get him out of here, the king's killing everybody under 2 years of age, so save him, you're going to have to take him to Egypt and hide him for 10 years, right? Until that king disappeared some way or another. And Jesus did all the things that little Hebrew boys did when he was a child. He had chores, right? And one of the things he had to do is take the wood ashes outside and put them in the garden. Next, please. Okay, these are the 90 essential nutrients. Oxygen is not optional. Water is not optional. These 90 essential nutrients are not optional. Not optional. We need 60 minerals, 16 vitamins, 12 essential amino acids, 3 essential fatty acids. And if you don't have any one of those, you can get 10, 20, 30, 40 diseases from one of those being missing. Calcium deficiency alone will give you 147 different diseases. You will need 27 specialists. Now you have to do a supplement properly and all those problems go away. Well, why would I want to do that? I have to ask my doctor. I hear that so much, I just say, I have to go pray, otherwise I get so angry. Now, 2/3 of those 90 essential nutrients are minerals. 60 of the 90 are minerals, so you have to focus a little bit on them because plants cannot make them. Plants only need 3 to be healthy. Plants only need 3 minerals to be healthy. We need 60. Okay? Now, here comes the scary part. Nutritional minerals do not occur in a uniform blanket around the crust of the earth. They occur like veins, like chocolate and chocolate ripple ice cream. And what the minerals are in a plant will be reflected by where they're grown. If you take a kid from Somalia, where the average lifespan is 29, you take a kid from Costa Rica, where the average lifespan is 90, you take the Costa Rican kid, ship him to Somalia, and feed him like a Somali kid, he's going to live to be 29. You take the Somalian kid and ship him to Costa Rica and feed him like a Costa Rican, he'll live to be 90. It has everything to do with what you eat. See, in animals, and I'm a veterinarian as well as a physician, in animals, we've leveled the playing field for animals, no matter where they live. They get these little alfalfa pellets with these 90 essential nutrients in them. We've eliminated 900 different diseases in animals with those little alfalfa pellets for diseases that still plague human beings. And so as a kid, I always wondered, well, why do we do that for animals? Nobody's doing it for people. So I started doing it for people 32 years ago, and lo and behold, thank you God, it works. It works. And so I've been doing this now for 32 years in human beings, and it works. Okay, next, please. Okay, these are the minerals that you need in blue. That's a periodic table. You can get that in any chemistry book. That's a periodic table. And the blue ones are the ones you need every day. And most medical doctors and nurses can't name 10 without reading the back of a cereal box. They get 30 minutes worth of nutrition in 14 years of pre-med, medical school, and residency and internship. It's not that they're bad, it's just they don't have the training. And so we have to be responsible here. We have to take in all 60 of those minerals every day, otherwise you get disease. Just like, how long could you go without oxygen? Try hold your breath for 3 hours, see how that works. It doesn't work very well. Try going without water for a week. That doesn't work very well either, especially if it's hot and humid, right? Okay, next, please. Okay, next. Okay, what I'd like you to do is think about supplementing with what we call the mighty 90. It's those 90 essential nutrients we all need. They are not optional. And then if you have a disease like diabetes, we have a program for diabetes. If you have high blood pressure, we have a program for high blood pressure. If you have arthritis, we have a program for arthritis. If you have lupus, we have a program for lupus, and so on. You just add that to the basic stuff. I know you all put oil in your car. How many of you put oil in your car? Make sure there's oil in your car. Of course. Now, why do you put oil in the car before the engine burns up? You put oil in the car to prevent the engine from burning up. You can take an engine 300,000 miles if you put oil in there appropriate for the model of the car or truck you're driving, and every 1,000 miles or every 3,000 miles, whatever they require, you change it, right? Why don't we do that for humans? Well, that's what I'm saying. You take those 90 essential nutrients, like just like we give pet animals and laboratory animals and livestock, and you'll add 25 to 50 healthy years of your life just by supplementing with those mighty 90 all the time. You cannot get everything you need just by eating well. Just remember those billionaires. If that were true, there'd be a lot of billionaires lived to be 100. And according to Forbes magazine, there are zero. Okay, next please. I love this slide. This is a really good piece of research by Harvard Medical School. And what they did was look county by county in the continental United States, the longevity of people. They did the longevity of people county by county. The longest lived people in America are in the blue and the purple, in the Midwest and the Upper Plains states, and the shortest lived people in America are in the yellow, orange, and red. Look where Atlanta's at. The people in the Midwest and the Upper Plains states literally live 25 years longer than y'all do. They live 25 years longer than you do. Not because God loves them any more than God loves you. He loves us all equally. We're told that in the Bible, and I believe that, right? And so I know you do too, otherwise you wouldn't be here tonight. And so what's the difference? Well, when they looked, they were trying to find which county had the best medical system associated with lifespan. They were going to make sure that every county had that medical system. What they found out, that every county had the same medical system. They had doctors who came from accredited medical schools. They had accredited hospitals. They had access to pharmaceuticals approved by the FDA. They had personal insurance, government insurance. Really, nobody was out without insurance. There's Medicare, Medicaid for people who can afford it, the people on Social Security. Everybody had that. But what they found out was it came down to how people cooked. The people in the Midwest and the Upper Plains states cooked everything by roasting, stewing, and baking. Now, how do people cook in the old Confederate states, in the old South? They fry everything. Now, there's rumors y'all fry water. I know you fry ice cream. Now you think about that. If all you do is give up fried foods or just eat it once a year for some unknown celebration, if you stop eating fried, I mean, you can go to KFC and eat, what is it, KRC or K whatever it is, grilled KGC. Sounds like the police from Russia, KGC. So you can go to those places. I mean, I live in McDonald's. But I don't eat any of the bad stuff. I don't eat French fries. I eat their burgers. I eat their Angus burgers with the mushrooms and the Swiss cheese. I don't eat the buns. I eat their steak, egg, and cheese breakfast. I don't eat the bagel. I do have their wild berry smoothie, which has all those antioxidants in there. I don't drink the sparkly soft drinks. You see, you can be in the world, but not of the world, right? Does that sound familiar? Oh, whoa! Okay, you take the good and leave the bad. Okay, next, please. Next. Okay, next. Okay. This is a place where we like to get minerals from. It's actually an ancient, I can't say seabed. This is actually underneath the seabed. These are plants. How many of you heard of the Great Flood? Okay. Well, that white stuff above that brown stuff is a 25-foot thick layer of limestone full of fossils of fish and seaweed and stuff like that. So you know it was an ancient seabed, but everything underneath it, that brown stuff looks like coffee grounds or ancient plants. It was a forest. It got covered during the Great Flood. Plants. 77 minerals in those plants. Okay, next. Okay, the third longest lived people on earth are the Yao people in China. And those are a couple of kids as a watercolor from 1,000 years ago. You don't see them eating fried chicken or fried potatoes or fried fish. You see them eating things that have antioxidants. And there's pomegranates in that basket and peaches in the basket. I mean, peaches, that must have thought of Georgia, right? And then there's watermelon, and that's because there's all those antioxidants in there. They were doing that 1,000 years ago. Next, please. Next, please. Next, please. Next. Next. Okay. The longest lived people on earth right now are a kind of a subculture in Costa Rica and Central America. They're called the Nicoyans. It's a little peninsula on the Pacific coast of Central America's Costa Rica. They live to be an average of 90. They have 100-year-old per 250 of their population, and they're still a third-world country, according to anthropologists. They're a third-world country. Place of poverty, tropical disease, tribal warfare is still going on, and yet they live 15 years longer than the average American. They have 20 times 100-year-olds we do, because they're still putting wood ashes in the gardens of their food, where they grow their food, just like Jesus did. Okay, next, please. All this remained the same until 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Monday, September 4th, 1882, and this fellow here, Thomas Edison, and his chief electrical technician, pulled the switch and turned on the first commercial electric generating plant. We know that because it was immortalized in newspapers and magazines with pictures and stories. 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Monday, September 4th, 1882, and by 1909, in the Sears catalog, you could buy no less than a dozen kitchen appliances that were run by electricity, including an electric stove. How many wood ashes, how many plant minerals are left over when you cook with electricity, propane, natural gas, kerosene, and heating oil? Zero! And nobody said, now you're responsible for supplementing with those minerals because you're not getting them as a byproduct of heat in your home anymore. And any doctor or anybody, any government, anybody who tells you, oh, don't worry about vitamins and minerals, just eat well, you get everything you need, you want to flee from that person because they're cutting 25 years off your life. Next, please. Just by cutting your calories in half, you'll double your lifespan. We've known this since 1501, a calorie-restricted diet. We've known that since 1501 when there was a book written called The Art of Living Long. The author was Luigi Carnero. That's a long story, so I won't tell it today. Next. They've done this in every species of animal you can think of, including primates, that group on the right there. They were both fed, both groups actually got fed the same Ralston Purina laboratory monkey pellets. The group on your right got a full cup every day. The group on your left got the same pellets, just a half a cup every day. The ones on your right, after that 20-year study at the University of Wisconsin, the ones on the right, half of them died from diabetes, heart attacks, and cancer, and obesity, because they were getting a full cup. The ones that got a half a cup are biologically half their age. Next, please. You ever heard of Nelson Mandela? Now, he's been using my minerals since 1991 when he got out of prison. Andy Young, right here from Atlanta, Georgia, sent him to him. I actually began to work with the Atlanta community in 1991 when Andy Young's son called me and said, my father is scheduled for a double knee replacement, and I don't want him to go through that surgery. I'm afraid. And he says, can you do anything for him? I know you work with athletes. So in 1991, through nutrition, I rebuilt Andy Young's knees, never had to have the surgery. And yet today, 20 years later, he's never had that surgery. Praise God. Next, please. How many ever heard, raise your hand, have you ever heard of celiac disease, irritable bowel syndrome, inflammatory bowel syndrome, Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis? They're all the same disease, just different degrees of severity. Right now, there's 30 to 50 out of every 100. You see down there in the bottom part of that story, the truthful is for every one diagnosed, there's probably 30 to 50 undiagnosed. Go to the next one. Go to the next one. Next one, next one, next one, next one. Okay, stop there. That's a little three-year-old baby, little Japanese baby, whose mother I know very well. She was breastfeeding him, and she had eczema and asthma. And doctors and the government and the public health service want you to think that asthma is caused by cockroach hairs. You've all heard that, right? Well, it's caused by cockroach hairs. And she was breastfeeding this baby, and he got asthma at 3 days of age, and he got all this dermatitis and eczema over his whole body. And so we got her on a gluten-free diet, got rid of all the grains out of her diet, got rid of all the grains out of her diet, and put her on all 90 essential nutrients. And in 3 days' time, her asthma got better, her dermatitis got better. In 2 weeks' time, it was gone. Let's see the next one. That's him 2 weeks later, completely free of asthma and completely free of eczema and dermatitis in just 2 weeks by treating the mother's nutritional problems. Now, here's the sad part about this. What the pediatrician was doing for this baby was giving him cortisone cream for the mama to smear on his skin so he wouldn't be itching and scratching, and put his hands in little mittens so he wouldn't scratch himself. Now, putting mittens on, is that going to solve a nutritional deficiency? I don't think so. So you have to ask second opinions, don't you? I mean, that was really way out there. Okay, next. Oh, there he is at 2 years old. Now, as long as he stays away from gluten, doesn't eat any grains. He can eat rice and millet, but not wheat, barley, rye, oats. As long as he stayed away from wheat, barley, rye, oats and supplemented with a Mighty 90, and he's getting his own Mighty 90 at his age there because he's not breastfeeding anymore, he will never have those diseases, and it will add 25 years to his life. But if he ever starts eating whole grains again because some nutritionist or some health person tells him to, or a sister who maybe has good intentions, well, you need to eat some whole grains. Bam, he's gone. Okay, next. See, you don't have to suffer through that for 20 years. In 3 days to 10 days, it's gone just by a gluten-free diet and taking the Mighty 90. Next. That must be Forrest Gump on the bottom. Okay, next. Next. Okay, that's what psoriasis looks like, and that'll go away in just a couple of weeks. I don't care if you've had it for 40 years. It'll go away in a couple of weeks on a gluten-free diet with a Mighty 90. Next. Next. This gal here, she'd been like that for 23 years, and I was down in Palm Springs, California, and her husband was one of our meetings, and she wouldn't come out into the public because she just, you know, was always scratching, and no matter what drug she, for 23 years she was like that on the front and the back. And after 2 days, it got 50% better, and in a week it was gone after 23 years. Now, that's a lot of suffering unnecessarily because they didn't get a second opinion. Okay, next, please. There's an athlete, and one in front. Now, she doesn't look too healthy to me, but she was heralded as a wonderful athlete. And then she died at 35, and she's, you know, guts just couldn't carry her on. Well, she had anorexia, which is caused by, and bulimia would be the same thing as caused by, eating disorders are caused by celiac disease. You hear people say, I just eat, I feel bad. When I fast, I feel good. When people say, I fast and I feel good, that means they can't eat the stuff they're eating. When they don't eat it, they feel better, okay? So that's already done the diagnosis. Next. You ever hear that guy? Michael Jackson had celiac disease. You ever hear that story where he was bleaching himself so he'd look white? He was a very dark little black kid when he was singing. And as he got older, he got lighter and lighter and lighter. The last 30 years of his life, those were wigs he was wearing. He had snow white hair. He had lupus. He had arthritis. Why do you think he wore that little jeweled glove? That was to hide the braces for his carpal tunnel syndrome. And he had a nutritionist who followed him everywhere and said, Michael, you need to eat more whole grains. And then he had to be put in hyperbaric oxygen chambers every day he was home because he couldn't live without that hyperbaric oxygen. Michael, you need more whole grains. Get healthy. And then he had to have injectable painkillers because he couldn't absorb the oral ones. And so whatever Dr. Murray gets for giving him something, you know, overdosing him, the nutritionist should also get the same penalty. It's kind of like a driver for the bank robbers. Somebody gets killed in the bank robbery, they always charge the driver with the murder too, don't they? Next, please. And when you have celiac disease, you cannot absorb these 60 minerals, and so you're going to get 900 diseases, and you will be treated by 17 to 25 specialists. Not a single one of them will say get off of gluten and take the Mighty 90. We're beginning to get a little picture here. Okay? Now, once you know this, it's just like knowing the Bible. Once you know about your spirit and your physical body, once you know that, nobody can tell you anything that's going to change your mind. Anytime you have a question, you go into the Bible. I live on the road 300 days out of every year. I sleep in hotels almost every night. And my best friend is at Gideon's Bible in that little nightstand next to the bed. And I trust that book more than any other book. Next. Let's see, I can't read that one. Oh, the metabolic syndrome. Okay, let's go to the metabolic syndrome. Thank you. The metabolic syndrome. This is high blood pressure, elevated blood cholesterol and triglycerides, and you're looking at insulin resistance, kind of a pre-diabetes, and then there's abdominal obesity. Okay? Now, when you have that, you're going to have a stroke, you're going to have a heart attack, you're going to have diabetes. Back in the old days, 25 years ago, they called that Syndrome X. Today they call it the metabolic syndrome. Okay, next. And when you look like that, you're in deep trouble. Isn't that funny? Hazardous waste. I thought that was kind of cute. Okay, next. This is just some of the things when you look at the metabolic syndrome, all the diseases that you get associated with that metabolic syndrome, and you're going to go to all these specialists. You're going to wind up on 27 to 50 prescription drugs, and all you have to do is get on a gluten-free diet and supplement with the Mighty 90, and they all go away in a couple of weeks. I don't know. I have to ask my doctor. Remember, why don't you ask Jesus? Remember, Jesus was putting those plant minerals, those wood ashes, in the gardens when he was only 2 years old. Next. You can read that next. That's the part of your body that's damaged by celiac disease and the metabolic syndrome. Okay, next. A lot of times when the doctor takes your gallbladder out, you have gallbladder symptoms, and you still have, how many of you have heard of somebody who's had their gallbladder removed and they still have their belly pain? That happens all the time. So the doctor says, well, I don't know what else to do. Let's just take the gallbladder out. Well, that didn't work. Let's try something else. Okay, next. Next, please. Okay. Let's see, I've got 10 minutes, so I'm going to start with, I'll finish with this one. This is high blood pressure. How many of you heard of high blood pressure? Okay, everybody knows that it's genetic, right? Particularly in the black community, because it occurs at a 40% higher rate in the black community than it does in the white community. But it's not true. It's totally a simple nutritional deficiency disease. It just occurs more frequently in the black population, not because of genetics, but because of diet culture. Okay? It's a totally simple nutritional deficiency disease. Let's go to the next one. Let's see. This one came out in 2008, I believe, and it said that it's more difficult to treat high blood pressure with the drugs now. You need different drugs. We need new drugs. The old ones aren't working. Why is that? Because celiac disease, you can't absorb drugs orally, just like Michael Jackson couldn't absorb painkillers orally because people are trying to eat more whole grains. Next, please. Salt is thought to be caused by or cause of high blood pressure. Salt is thought to be the cause of high blood pressure, at least related to high blood pressure, right? Salt has nothing to do with high blood pressure. What's the first thing that a good farmer puts out for his livestock? A salt block. There's nobody out in a pasture telling a cow she's limited to one lick a day, is there? I refuse to believe that my patients are dumber than a cow, right? Okay, next. Next. Okay, I love this. We'll end with this one here. That'll be about right. And then we'll ask for God's blessing for the right direction. Right? This was a great study in Scientific American. This is February 1999 when it came out. And what they did was send a team of researchers, DNA researchers and genetics researchers, to the forest of Nigeria to look for one black guy that had normal genes for blood pressure. What they were going to do is take his genes and genetically engineer them, make a vaccine, and come back to America and inject every black guy with this vaccination. That was their goal. That was the spoken goal. And so what they did was they get out there, and they go out in the forest of Nigeria, as they were instructed to do, and they get out there, and only 7% of the people out there had high blood pressure. 93% were normal. They said, we got to check this book. That can't be right. That's not what we were told. And so they come back to Chicago and they do a lot of DNA testing, and they find a lot of people whose ancestors had originated in Nigeria from the old slave days, where they were taking the slaves from the west coast of Africa to Europe and to North America and so on. And they found thousands of them who had that background. And so they started taking their blood pressure, and 33% of the people in Chicago that fit that genetic profile actually had high blood pressure. So you know immediately, without any more testing, it's not genetic, because your position on earth doesn't affect how a genetic disease manifests itself, right? And so why would it be 7% high blood pressure in Nigeria and 33% in Chicago? Well, that's because the people in Nigeria are third world country. And they're still using wood for fuel and putting wood ashes in their garden. They're getting all those minerals. And the guys in Chicago are living on fried chicken, fried fish, and using calcium channel blockers. Are we getting a picture? So who's better off there when it comes to health and high blood pressure? Those dudes living out in the woods in Nigeria are better off, okay, instead of getting all this medicine and medical advice, is the point that I'm trying to make here. Okay, let's go to the next one. Let's go to the next one. Oh, no, stop there. Stop there. That's good. This is actually from 2005, 6 years later, after that study came out, 2005. It was published in the British Medical Journal. For 6 years, the geneticist at Harvard, Oxford, at Oxford Medical School, gleaned through all that data that they had collected in Nigeria. And after 6 years of research, they said, high blood pressure in blacks, not genetic. High blood pressure in whites, not genetic. High blood pressure in human beings, not genetic. High blood pressure in dogs, not genetic. High blood pressure is not genetic. It's a simple mineral deficiency disease. Now, that's why I love Pastor Dollar and Pastor Taffy, because they practice what we're talking about here. I know Pastor Dollar, he just guzzles supplements. That's how he can do all these things he does. I mean, he's superhuman, right? He's got the blessing. Okay, next. Now, one of the things you ladies will love to hear is there's a new category of vitamins out. It's called dark chocolate. Now, that's gospel. That's gospel truth. Even Harvard Medical School, and this was published in the Journal of the American Medical Association, I think it was August 27, 2003, and they found these substances, these organic substances in dark chocolate, not milk chocolate, right? Not milk chocolate. But these substances they found in dark chocolate called polyphenols and flavanols and PEAs, phenylethylamines, they actually will reduce blood pressure. Now, they won't cure the mineral deficiency, but it's kind of like a safe prescription, right? You eat dark chocolate and high blood pressure goes away. I mean, that's good, isn't it? To be able to eat chocolate, which we always thought of being sinful. Well, milk chocolate is sinful because you just get fat when you eat milk chocolate. But when you drink, when you eat dark chocolate, you will lose weight, and your blood pressure goes down. Now, that is so exciting. That is so exciting when you think about it. Plus, it has so many antioxidants that the dark chocolate will also protect you from cancer, protect you from coronary artery disease, cataracts, macular degeneration, Alzheimer's disease. And if you fellas want to get on the good side of the ladies for Valentine's Day, for birthdays, Christmas, right? You want to be stuffing dark chocolate everywhere. And so what I want to do is end today with thanking again Pastor Dollar and Pastor Taffy and thanking you for your blessed company. And tomorrow night we're going to cover about six other major diseases as we have here tonight with high blood pressure. You now have the basics. You know more about nutrition than all the medical doctors in the world. So I applaud you for being here. I really applaud you for taking the time to come and learn this so we can take care of our physical body. Give yourself a hand. Take care of our physical body as well as our spirit. God bless you all. God bless you all. See you tomorrow and bring somebody with you. God bless you.
Now, I need to let you know something now. He's 74 years young.
No, 71.
71 years young. And I think it was my baby who was having asthma. Mm-hmm. And we applied those things. She don't have it anymore.
Hallelujah.
Eczema. She don't have that anymore. And, you know, it was an amazing thing that when we look at the scriptures in Proverbs 18:21, it says death and life is in the power of the tongue, but it's also in the power of the taste, isn't it?
That's right. Well, that's part of the tongue.
Yeah, it's part of the tongue. Now, there's this weird thing going on with high cholesterol.
We're going to talk about that tomorrow.
You're going to talk about that tomorrow?
Yeah. You want to say something now?
Yeah. Because, you know, they put out all this weird stuff about cholesterol. And they tell you what you can't eat and all that other kind of stuff. Give them a little taste of that. And then
okay. Well, here's the short version you're going to hear tomorrow, just big tomorrow. There's not a single disease caused by elevated blood cholesterol and triglycerides. Does not cause stroke, does not cause heart disease. And the medical system has known this for 50 years. We're going to tell you what actually causes coronary artery disease, heart attacks, and stroke tomorrow.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Joel Wallach. Amen. Thank you, sir. Now, hey, Doc, you got a table? a table outside with the website and materials that we can get. Books, CDs. Now, it's important that you go to his website because he also carries a line of product that you might be interested in getting in your own life, and it's some good stuff, folks. So stop by the table, check it out, get some information. You don't want to miss tomorrow. Wasn't that something about the ash?
Yeah.
If you plant collard greens on the side of the house, you might want to do it. It makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? And the fried foods, of course, I just realized in Texas they were frying ice cream.
Yeah, that's true.
God, man.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you, sir. Did you learn anything tonight? What you heard means it's your responsibility. And if you don't accept the responsibility for good health, you might be coming to church praying for God to heal you, only to go back home and get unhealed. You follow what I'm saying? And like I said, if you want to hide something from people, sometimes you just put it in a book and it stays hidden. And we're going to have to understand, you know, sometimes if you allow generations of wrong cooking to continue to spread and you don't correct it, then that's why everybody's dying the same time, and that's why everybody's dying of the same thing. Not because, you know, you'll hear, well, you inherited that, you know, that's a part of your makeup. No, it's not. And you can change it. You can make it, you can make the difference in your life. And we want you to live long, and we want you to live strong. I mean, the Bible, I mean, at least 100, it says 70, and then by strength, 80. So what he is saying there is, by strength is wisdom. When he uses that word strength, if you want to live longer than 70, which is the minimum age, by strength or by wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, you live longer. And it's just so simple. It's just paying attention to what you're equipping your body with every day to be able to do what needs to be done. If you don't equip it with the necessary equipment, it's not going to work the way it's supposed to work. It's just not going to do it. Well, praise the Lord. It's just not going to, it just doesn't work like that. But if you'll begin to equip your body with the proper, he calls it the 90. And then, you know, you can take vitamins and not take minerals, it won't work. You can take minerals and not take vitamins, it won't work. And very few people know about essential fatty acids, and just an amazing thing that happens if you just pop one EFA a day. You know, you avoid strokes and heart attacks for the rest of your life. Just one little pill. And so he's going to talk to you about some of that stuff tomorrow. And, you know, people always get on me about my eggs. And I'm telling you, I ain't never had nothing wrong with my cholesterol, and I have eggs all the time. They're my eggs. And somebody, when I got back in town, they told me, oh, something wrong with the eggs. And I was like, well, what are my eggs? They said, well, didn't you hear? I said, no, I've been out of town. What's wrong with them? Well, somebody said something. I'm like, well, just cook them harder or something like that. What is it? Amen. Well, I'm going to let you take advantage of getting out of here early. How many of you planning on coming back tomorrow night to get some stuff? Do you enjoy this? Because if we need to do this a little bit more often, we can. But I want to let you get out of here so you can go to the table, get some information. If you don't do anything else, get that website and avail yourself to the website. And I will see you tomorrow. God bless you. Good night. But, you know, the powerful thing is that you remembered. Sit down just for a moment. Let's receive the offering. If you need an offering envelope, raise your hands. Now, some of y'all are like, I'm already up, so I'm finna get ready to go. Well, hey, you know what you need God to do. And some of y'all hollered out like, y'all, we got to take the offering up. I got to get some stuff done. Lift your hands up if you need an offering envelope. Raise your hands. Sometimes it's the practical things that we learn. I mean, the whole motto of this ministry is, and all you're getting what? Get understanding. It's what we don't understand that sometimes destroys us. This is why we decided, let's have 2 days of talking about health. so you can see. Did y'all hear some things that surprised you? Especially with Michael Jackson, you didn't. Of course, you knew those were wigs, right? You didn't. Yep. Be surprised what TV can do for you. Now, let's sow the seed tonight for good health. But now notice, it's not just the seed that's going to do it. You're going to have to make some decisions on your own to accept responsibility for good health. Here's another thing that I didn't know about. The wonders of getting a massage. Oh, some of y'all know, huh? Dude, it's like heaven sometimes, you know? When they're real good, I'm sleep slobbing through that little hole. You wake up, what happened? Blood circulation and all that, but then it ain't gonna do no good if you keep going and getting fried chicken and fried ice cream. Dude, here's the bottom line. I hate to say it, but I gotta say it. You gotta let the fried stuff go. Did I say get in bunnies? You heard, he didn't even tell you get in bunnies. Now, he just told you very simply, you know, pick some special occasions. But, you know, fried food, you know, 4 or 5 times every month, you gotta let that stuff go. That stuff go. I mean, you might eat one more drumstick and then. You hear how Doc did it tonight? Wham! Died. Wham! Out of here. I'm like, wow, that's deep. But that's the truth. That's the truth. Well, hold your offerings up tonight. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to sow into the kingdom of God. We sow into good health. We live long and we will finish strong. We thank you for this opportunity to give. It's our gratitude, it's our love, it's our appreciation. And Lord, bless this congregation. Bless the world changes churches, all of us, you know, one church in many locations. And as we sow tonight, we thank you so much for the revelation, the information, and the wisdom, the strength that's been imparted into us tonight and that we'll receive tomorrow. We give you praise and glory for it. Now, in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Let's just go ahead and receive the offering. Now, if you're here tonight and you have never made Jesus the Lord of your life and you'd like to get born again tonight, somebody says, well, if I'd have known this stuff before I got whatever I got, then I wouldn't got it. Well, you know what? Now, here's the good news. You can be healed. You can be healed and then operate in health. And so you want to come to the altar to receive Jesus as your Lord, rededicate your life, receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, or even to join this church or wherever you may be tonight, then we want to give you that opportunity to do that. I just believe that you don't have to die when you're 30. Amen. You don't have to fall dead when you're 42. We can live long and we can live strong. But we got to make some decisions. We got to decide what goes in this body. We got to decide it. I mean, you know, you just got to make a decision to do what needs to be done. And I know it's not easy. I got up and went to exercise this morning, and I wasn't feeling it at all. I wasn't feeling none of it. I was just like, I'm just going to make myself come, and it's up to Dwayne to push me. Because other than that, I don't want to do none of this. But you just got to decide that you're going to do whatever you need to do and make things happen the way they need to happen. You got to eat like you're supposed to eat. You know, if you want to go home and eat chocolate cake all day and stop by certain fast food places, then understand you're robbing yourself of some life that you need in order to complete the will of God for your life. So why do we want to live long? So we can complete fully the will of God for our lives. The will of God for our lives. Amen. We're not doing what we do so we can, you know, dress up in Speedos and, well, you know what I'm talking about. It's not to make a parade. I mean, some of y'all too old for that anyway. So it's to live. It's to live long and live strong. Amen. Say out loud. I live long and I live strong. Say I live long and I finish strong. Amen. So at this time, if you want to come down to this altar, I'm going to ask the congregation to stand, minister to the people to your left, to your right, front, behind. If they need some help in coming down, you help them come down. You can do so at this time. Congregation, don't you appreciate those who've come down tonight? Amen. Father, we thank you for the anointing of God upon these precious people to remove every burden and destroy every yoke in their lives. I thank you, Lord, they'll never be the same again. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, if you'll turn and follow our deacons to the prayer room, they're going to take you and minister to you and give you biblical understanding of how to obtain and maintain what you came to receive. You'll never be the same again. All right. I appreciate that. I don't know what I was doing, just walking off stage, wasn't doing nothing, you know. Thank God for a smart congregation. Praise the Lord. Every now and then you need to help your preacher out, you know what I mean? Oh, well, may the blessings of God be upon all of you. And I speak good health on you. I come into agreement with you on that. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. God bless you. Tomorrow night, same time. Oh, praise God. Father, you're so worthy tonight. You're so worthy tonight. And we just love you. We give you glory and we give you praise. Oh, we love you, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. Move up and down every aisle, in and out every row. Touch and heal, deliver, set free and make whole. You're so worthy to be praised, Lord. So worthy to be praised. Now in the name of Jesus, I speak to sickness and disease right now. And I command you by the authority of Jesus Christ, you go from this place. And I thank you, Lord, that you sent your word and it healed and delivered. And Lord, we love you with all of our hearts and souls and mind and strength. Maybe the power of the Holy Spirit be a part of our lives and be a part of our walk. Now, Father, we ask that you bless this night. The wisdom of God fill this place. Let us get answers, Lord. We love you so much, and we're so grateful. So grateful for all that you do in our lives, Lord. And Lord, help us not to complain or murmur, but to look past whatever the situation is and to be able to give you thanks and praise for all that you do in our lives. Lord, we love you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. It's in Jesus' mighty name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a big hand clap of praise. Amen. Well, turn around and greet your neighbors and welcome them here tonight. Y'all came back tonight. Amen. Praise God. You may be seated. Hey, I don't want to waste any time. Let's welcome Dr. Joel Wallach as he comes tonight. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Oh, thank you, Pastor Dollar and Pastor Taffy and his whole crew. They've been so wonderful. Really appreciate the help that everybody's given. And I have to thank the greatest physician of all, right, who has always been, who is, and who will ever be the greatest physician, our Lord Jesus. And we love him forever. And I know he loves us forever. And I appreciate you being here. I know we're on the right track because many of you come back. I do see and recognize faces. And I'm glad you're here because we're going to talk about detail tonight that you wouldn't have believed yesterday. For those of you who were here yesterday, you understand that what we covered was pretty outrageous. This is going to be 10 times more outrageous tonight because oftentimes the truth is outrageous. And just for those that weren't here last night, just very briefly, the human being requires certain elements to be healthy. These things are not optional. Everybody knows we need oxygen. Everybody knows we need water. But oftentimes they don't know that we need these 90 essential nutrients, 60 minerals, 16 vitamins, 12 essential amino acids, and 3 essential fatty acids, because we've been given misinformation. Physicians will tell you, oh, just eat well, you get everything you need from your food. That's not true. Minerals, for instance, make up 2/3 of the 90 essential nutrients. And minerals do not occur in a uniform blanket around the crust of the earth. They occur in veins like chocolate and chocolate ripple ice cream. And a plant only needs 3 minerals to be healthy and make good seeds for the next generation. Human beings need 60. So you can eat a pretty good slice of organically grown multigrain bread and be 57 minerals short and wind up with lots of diseases. Because they're called essential nutrients because if you're missing them, you get diseases. Calcium deficiency, for instance, you can wind up with 147 different diseases and need 30 different specialists. You'll be on at least 50 different prescription drugs. And all you have to do is supplement with the 90, we call it the Mighty 90, and with special attention to calcium, and in a few weeks, a few months, all 30 to 50 of those diseases are gone. Praise God. So we're going to talk about that tonight. We're going to cover, I believe, about 5 major diseases, and then we're going to open it up for some questions. The pastor gave me permission to answer questions a little bit. We'll have some fun with that. And so if we could have that first slide, we're going to do a little review from yesterday for those that weren't here. We're going to start out with high blood pressure. High blood pressure is not genetic. I'm going to say this to the different points of the compass because I know it's kind of a shock. High blood pressure is not genetic. High blood pressure is not genetic. High blood pressure is a simple mineral deficiency disease that can afflict anybody. Simple mineral deficiency disease. You supplement with the minerals, you don't get it. If you don't supplement with the minerals, you do get high blood pressure, and if you supplement with minerals, it goes away. It's just that simple. High blood pressure medication can lower blood pressure, but it doesn't solve the problem that caused the high blood pressure. You can symptomatically reduce high blood pressure, but you're still going to die from the complications of high blood pressure, even if though your blood pressure is, quote, under control, unquote. So once you appreciate that, you're going to add 25 to 50 healthful years to your life. We can go to the next slide, please. And of course, it's getting more difficult today to control high blood pressure with medications. And they have to give you three different medications, and some medications are combinations of two and three medications. They didn't have to do that years ago. Years ago, they could give you one medication and get your blood pressure down into the normal range. But it's difficult today because of a disease we call celiac disease. It's also known as irritable bowel syndrome, inflammatory bowel disease, ulcerative colitis, or Crohn's disease, which are all the same disease, just different degrees of severity. And if you have any of these problems, which show up as constipation, diarrhea, dermatitis, eczema, asthma, you can wind up people with 20 different diseases usually have celiac disease. You give up gluten, no wheat, barley, rye, and oats. Within a couple of weeks, you're considerably better. Within a couple of months, usually most of those diseases are gone when you take the Mighty 90, the 90 essential nutrients with the gluten-free diet. And so we can go to the next slide. And salt, everybody wants to tell you that salt is a bad thing. Salt is somehow related to high blood pressure. Whether you believe it or not, how many of you have heard that salt has something to do with high blood pressure? Okay, good, we've all heard that. Well, the first thing that a good farmer puts out for his livestock is a big salt block, right? And there's nobody out in the pasture telling a cow she's limited to one lick a day, is there? And so I refuse to believe my human patients are dumber than a cow. So I said, look, go ahead and just salt your food to taste. Don't worry about it. And people will say, well, every time I use salt, I swell up. My ankles get all fat, you know, and swollen. And I get worried about that. Well, when you swell up, when you get edema in your ankles and your face and your hands, when you use salt, that means that you have a low blood protein. You eat 4 to 6 eggs every day, and within 2 weeks you can salt your food with impunity and you won't swell up anymore. You raise that blood protein up. People say to me, well, I can't eat eggs because my doctor said I got to worry about cholesterol. We're going to cover that in a minute. Remember I told you a lot of misinformation? When we get to that part, you are going to be shocked. Okay, let's go to the next one. That little box down there in the middle, this was actually the same study I just showed you on salt. That particular study was actually a government study called the Sodium Task Force. They said medical doctors want you to get your salt intake to 1 gram a day, which is kind of like a half a teaspoon of salt a day. And if you do that, it increases your risk of dying of a heart attack by 600%. By following the doctor's advice, it increases your risk of death from a heart attack by 600%. If you defy your doctor and take double and triple the dose of salt that they're recommending, you actually live 25 years longer and don't die of a heart attack. Isn't that amazing? Okay, that's a government study. Okay, next. Again, for those of you who weren't here last night, this is a big study published in February of 1999 in Scientific American. Scientific American sent a group of genetic and DNA scholars to Nigeria. They went out into the forest of Nigeria, and their task was to find one black tribesman who had normal genes for blood pressure. They were going to take his blood and genetically engineer him and make a vaccine and come back to America and inject every black man with his vaccine to get everybody's blood pressure down to normal. When they got to Nigeria, they were shocked to find out that only 7% of the people in Nigeria had high blood pressure, 93% were normal. They were just shocked because in Chicago, the number or the percentage of people who had high blood pressure who had a genetic relationship to Nigeria from the old slave days, 33% had high blood pressure in Chicago, but only 7% in Nigeria. And that tells you immediately that it's not genetic, because your position on earth doesn't determine how a genetic disease will manifest itself. So if it was genetic, it'd be 7% in Nigeria and 7% in America. Or if it was genetic, it'd be 33% in Chicago and 33% in Nigeria. But the fact that this big disparity tells you immediately it's not genetic. So what was the difference? Why these people in Nigeria were protected? Well, because they actually were primitive. They had no electricity, and so they still use wood for fuel to heat in their homes and cook their food. And they would take the wood ashes and use that as a fertilizer, and wood ashes is a misnomer, because the stuff that's left when you burn wood for fuel is not really ashes, it's the minerals that the tree had picked up out of the ground. You burn the carbon, and these minerals are put into the gardens. The okra and the sweet potatoes and the onions and the tomatoes and corn take up these minerals. You eat those foods, you get the minerals in that fashion. Well, how many of you, raise your hand, how many of you live entirely out of a garden and never go to a grocery store anymore? Well, looky there. Okay, well, that's a big problem, as you'll see in a moment. Okay, next slide, please. Well, over the next 6 years, the scientists from Oxford University in England, in London, England, these were people who were genetics experts. They poured through all that information and data. And in 2005, they published in the British Medical Journal, which is the equivalent of the Journal of the American Medical Association here, which is a very respectable medical journal, JAMA. They said in the British Medical Journal in January of 2005 that high blood pressure is not genetic. High blood pressure is not genetic. And so I want everybody on the count of three to yell hallelujah. One, two, three. Hallelujah! It's not genetic! Which means you can control it. You don't need permission from anybody. You can control it just by supplementing with the Mighty 90. And that's it. You learn how to take your own blood pressure, and it slowly goes away over a period of a month or two. I've had people who are on blood pressure medication for 40, 45 years, and in 2 weeks' time, they don't have high blood pressure anymore. They go back to a normal life. Men get sexier. They don't have that, you know, low T and ED and all them initial things. Okay, next. Another thing for the ladies, it's really fun to lower your blood sugar. Now, this won't fix the problem because it's not a mineral, but dark chocolate is now thought to be the third category of vitamins. Everybody knows about water-soluble vitamins, the B vitamins and C, and the fat-soluble vitamins A, D, E, and K. Now, there's a third category of vitamins. This was published in the Journal of the American Medical Association August 27, 2003. And it says that dark chocolate is, in fact, the third category of vitamins because of the polyphenols and PEAs, the phenylethylamines, and the flavanols in there will lower blood pressure. And there's no negative side effect, and so you can just have a lot of fun. Say, I'm going to help you lower your blood pressure on Valentine's Day. Here, have some dark chocolate, right? A lot of fun. Okay, next. Oh, yeah, we have one. It's a liquid called Youngevity, and we have little pieces that are called Triple Treat. Triple Treat. We'll talk about Triple Treat in Youngevity later. We can go to the next one. Okay. So you know how to prevent and reverse high blood pressure. You just take the Mighty 90. If you have celiac disease, you have to give up wheat, but if you don't have barley, rye, and oats, but if you don't have celiac disease, you just take the Mighty 90. You learn how to take your own blood pressure. If you can't afford the instrument to do it yourself, you just go to a pharmacy, and you sit in that chair, and you get your free blood pressure. You can do it twice a day if you want, right? Okay, now we want to talk about cholesterol. Whether you believe it or not, raise your hand if you've ever heard that cholesterol, elevated blood cholesterol, and elevated blood triglycerides have something to do with stroke and clogged arteries and heart attacks and stuff like that. Sure, if you don't raise your hand, you're lying because everybody's heard that, right? Or you're asleep already. Okay. Well, there's not a single disease that is caused by elevated blood cholesterol and triglycerides. There's not a single disease that is caused by elevated blood cholesterol and triglycerides. There's not a single disease that's caused by elevated blood cholesterol and triglycerides. The medical community has known that since 1971. But there's not a single law at any level, at the federal, or the state, or the county, or the city level, that forces a doctor to cure you and there's a cure available. In our heart of hearts, we'd like to believe that they're altruistic and they want to help you, right? But there's not a single law requiring them to cure you when there's a cure available. So you make up your own mind. Well, if it's not elevated blood cholesterol and triglycerides that cause stroke and heart disease and clogged arteries, well, first of all, what does having elevated blood cholesterol and triglycerides mean? Well, it usually means that you have diabetes or prediabetes or low thyroid, or you have a deficiency of niacin, which is vitamin B3. You can have deficiencies or ratio problems between omega-3s and omega-6s, fish oils kind of things, or flaxseed oils. And you could have deficiencies of chromium and vanadium. Two trace minerals are involved in maintaining normal blood sugar and normal blood fats. You have deficiencies of all those things will cause elevated blood cholesterol and triglycerides, but elevated blood cholesterol and triglycerides do not cause any disease. So if that's true, what causes stroke and clogged arteries and heart attacks? We can go to the next one. There it is. It's the hidden killer. Hold your hats now. Hold on to the seats, because here it comes. Next slide. Bam! There it is. Oreo cookies. Because about 70 years ago, the original Oreo cookie, that little white icing in between the chocolate wafers, was real butter and heavy whipping cream, but it would melt at room temperature and it would make the paper bags they were sold in on retail shelves oily. So the chemist at Oreo Cookies came up with what's called trans fatty acids, which they synthetically made, and they won't melt even at 380 degrees, let alone room temperature, right? But for looks and for shelf life, it was the most wonderful thing that ever happened. But it had one itsy bitsy tiny little unintended consequence. It plugs your arteries and causes stroke and heart attack. Now, you've all heard the inflammation theory now of disease, right? That's kind of the talk around the inflammation theory of disease. Well, it's that trans fatty acid that causes inflammation and stroke and plugged arteries because it irritates the lining of your arteries. Same thing with processed meats, deli slices, sausage, ham, bacon, bologna, salami, pastrami, pepperoni, jerky, corned beef, Spam, hot dogs, anything with nitrates and nitrites in it increases your risk of colon cancer, ovarian cancer, breast cancer, prostate cancer, and coronary artery disease, dementias. You know, eating a corned beef sandwich on, what is it, March 15th or 17th, March 17th, St. Patty's Day is okay once a year, but having it for breakfast, lunch, and dinner is going to kill you early, 25 years early. So you want to stay away from those processed meats, as well as fried foods. Fried foods cause trans fatty acids, right? There's no good fried foods when it comes to health. You have to make that decision. We talked about that last night. If you give up fried foods except once a year sometime, pick some arbitrary holiday, and have fried food once a year, you might get away with it, but don't have it every day. Don't have fried eggs for breakfast and French fries for lunch and fried chicken for dinner. You're going to die 40 to 50 years early. You avoid those foods, you'll add 25 to 50 healthy years to your life. Let's go to the next one, please. The first slide I showed yesterday when it came to health, it was Time magazine cover, it said that our next generation will not live as long as us. How many of you have heard that? Raise your hand if you've heard that our next generation is not going to live as long as us. I think most people have heard that by now. And that is because of a study that was done out of the University of Missouri, my old alma mater in Columbia, Missouri, came out 3 years ago, and they examined 300 five-year-old kids. They examined 300 five-year-old kids. They did a little ultrasound study on their carotid arteries. What they were looking for to see if there were the beginnings of clogging at age five. And they found out that these little five-year-olds were 65% blocked. They were 65% blocked. Because when I was a kid, we were weaned off of formula and off of breast milk onto peas and carrots and soup and things like that. Well, today we wean our kids off of formula onto things like chicken McNuggets and French fries and Oreo cookies. Don't do that anymore because those trans fatty acids are clogging their arteries. Well, the medical system's approach is to use cholesterol-lowering drugs when they're 8 years old. They're already starting a campaign to begin to use these statin drugs, Lipitor, to lower cholesterol in kids when they're 8 years old. We do not want to do that, and you'll see why in a moment. Next slide, please. Margarine is the worst type of fat for your heart. Now, who told you to give up butter and eggs and cream and lard to cook with? Who told you to give that up and go to margarine and cooking oils? The doctors, whose average lifespan, those of you who were here yesterday, the average lifespan of a primary care physician, a family doctor in America is 56. Why would you listen to a group of people on how to live a long, healthful life whose average lifespan is 56? It doesn't compute. The reason I believe in Jesus is because he always tells the truth, right? I'm going to stick with him. Okay, next. Now, I love this story. This fellow here, 88 years old, and this is published in the New England Journal of Medicine, one of the most prestigious medical journals. This old dude is 88 years old. He eats 25 eggs a day. Now, why would this old dude in 1991 be eating 25 eggs a day? Well, the reason is, I mean, you have to ask yourself, I mean, maybe he ate 25 eggs a day because he didn't have any teeth and couldn't eat steaks anymore. Or maybe he owned an egg ranch and, you know, was quality checking his product. But the reality is, when you read that scientific article, the more eggs he ate, he realized he became more studly. He became more studly the more eggs he ate. Because testosterone is 95% by weight cholesterol. So, when you go on a cholesterol-restricted diet and you go from cream and butter and eggs and lard to margarine and cooking oils, and you take drugs to lower your cholesterol, there's nobody home. So, ladies, if you want your man to be studly, 6 to 10 eggs a day. Now, they cannot be fried. They can be soft poached, they can be soft boiled, they can be soft scrambled in butter, not margarine or oils. Now, I can tell you from personal experience, I'm 71 years old and 10 eggs a day works. Hoo-ah! See, now the ladies, gentlemen, the ladies understand what I'm talking about. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, well, low-fat diets are just going away because when they compare the amount of heart attacks and cancer and other diseases that have been associated with high-fat diets, there's no difference between a low-fat diet and a high-fat diet when it comes to heart disease and cancer and so on. Okay, next, please. Now, so how do you prevent getting clogged arteries eating 10 eggs a day? Well, you just take the Mighty 90 and don't eat fried foods and don't eat processed meats with nitrates and nitrites. And if you already have clogged arteries, you add a little program to it, to the Mighty 90. There's a little sidebar here, which we'll talk about in a minute. We just call them the daily tablets. We'll just call them the daily tablets. Okay, you take those along with the Mighty 90 and Katie bar the door. Okay, everything opens up. Now, the next thing we want to talk about is dementias. How many of you ever heard of Alzheimer's disease? Raise your hand. Okay, good. Now, Alzheimer's disease is a physician-caused disease. It's not genetic. Alzheimer's disease is a physician-caused disease. It is not genetic. Now, you're not the mom of a doctor, are you? Okay. Now, listen, my wife is a surgeon. I love doctors. I love doctors, and they do have their place. But in this case, doctors have caused this disease. 40 years ago, Alzheimer's disease didn't exist even by another name. Alzheimer's disease did not exist 40 years ago even by another name. Today, it's the number four killer of adults over the age of 65. So just a short period of time has become a huge, huge problem for industrialized countries. 85% of all Alzheimer's disease is diagnosed in the world. I'm going to repeat that. 85% of all Alzheimer's disease diagnosed in the world is diagnosed in America. It's an American disease created by American doctors. Because 75% of your brain weight is a fatty insulation material called myelin. How many of you have heard of myelin? Okay, good. Myelin makes up 75% of your brain weight. It's the white matter of the brain, the gray matter, the thinking cells and the memory cells sit on top of the white matter, which is this white fatty insulation material, makes up 75% of your brain weight. And when the myelin goes away, you get Alzheimer's disease because the naked nerve fibers all shard out and they look for nerve tangles with CAT scans, and that's how they diagnose Alzheimer's disease. Well, Alzheimer's disease is caused by this myelin going away. Myelin makes up 75% of your brain weight, and myelin is 100% cholesterol. So if you're on a cholesterol-restricted diet, you're taking cholesterol-lowering drugs, guess what you're going to get? Alzheimer's disease. So you have to dump the cholesterol-lowering drugs. You have to start eating 10 eggs a day. No fried foods, no margarines, no cooking oils, and take the Mighty 90. You take the Mighty 90, and the odds of you getting Alzheimer's disease is
zero.
Zero. I want you to think about your grandparents. Think of all the eggs and all the cooking they did and lard and everything. They didn't have Alzheimer's disease. They died 92, 110, stuff like that. Okay, next. This is a U.S. News World Report, February of this year, 2010. And they're talking about the 80 million baby boomers coming along, living to be 100. In that upper right-hand corner there, it's a summary of one of the chapters that says, seven habits that you can do to lower your risk of Alzheimer's disease. That tells you right there that Alzheimer's disease is not genetic. Because there's no habit you can do that's going to reduce the risk of a genetic disease. See, they know it. Seven habits that you can do that's going to reduce your risk of getting Alzheimer's disease. Don't eat fried foods. Don't eat processed meats with nitrates and nitrites. Take the Mighty 90, and you won't get it. Next. That's just some of that myelin, shows all that fatty stuff around those nerve fibers. Next. There's a tidal wave coming of Alzheimer's disease because there's 80 million baby boomers coming along who did whatever the doctors told them. I want to live to be 100. I'm a baby boomer. We want to be the first generation where everybody lives to be 100. Will you lower your cholesterol and you'll live to be 100? Gimme, gimme, gimme. I want the newest cholesterol-lowering drug. Give me an overdose of that one, doc. Well, the unintended consequence is low T, ED, and if you could remember, Alzheimer's disease. Next. Costs $12,000 a month to maintain an Alzheimer's patient. And you're going to pay for it. You are literally going to pay for it out of your Social Security checks when you get there. Next. And let's see. Oh, yeah, Alzheimer's in an unrelenting upward trajectory. And again, they're picking on the baby boomers because they're the ones taking all the cholesterol-lowering drugs and eating the cholesterol-restricted diet. Next. Ultra-fat diet is actually therapeutic. I've been doing this for things like MS, multiple sclerosis, Lou Gehrig's disease, Parkinson's disease, dementias, including Alzheimer's disease. Totally preventable. You know, people like Muhammad Ali. We could actually solve his problem, but you can't get to him because he's got all these layers of agents and representatives and stuff, so you can't get to him to help him, right? But at any rate, I talk about 65% of the calories in your diet having to come from good fats, eggs, red meat, not processed meat, but, you know, good steak every day, pound of hamburger a day keeps the doctor away kind of thing. And they said, okay, we're going to show Wallach wrong. What they found out was they could get rid of all those diseases by giving you 90% of your calories coming from fat. 90% of your calories. And that's from the medical school at New York City. Next. Now, this came out in 1992. It said that just vitamin E alone could actually help people with advanced Alzheimer's disease. Vitamin E alone can actually help people with Alzheimer's disease, just one out of the 90. And nobody wanted to believe that. This study was done by the University of California, San Diego, and the Salk Institute that made the Salk vaccine. I mean, we're talking about respectable institutions here. There was a big firestorm over that because when I read that title in 1993, I said, and that means it cannot be genetic. And there was actually a firestorm set off in the media by that presentation I gave. And so universities and the Salk Institute redid it. Next slide, please. 5 years later, the headline was bigger. Vitamin E might slow Alzheimer's disease. And you can, same agency said, oh, it's getting bigger here. Now the next one, and I'll have to tell you what this says, Johns Hopkins University, where that terrible event happened today, right? Johns Hopkins University up in Baltimore, Maryland. They did a study in Cache County, Utah, and they picked Cache County, Utah because these were all Mormon farmers. These guys all ate the same diet. They're all very faithful to the religious dietary laws, and they lived 10 years longer than the average American. They lived to be 85 instead of 75. They gave half of them, of 5,000 of these people for a 10-year period, just vitamin C and vitamin E. They got crazy over the nutrients, so they gave two instead of one. Instead of 90, they gave two, vitamin C and E. And the other half, they gave a sugar pill. Nobody knew who got the sugar pill and who got the vitamins. Well, at the end of the 10 years, the ones who got the vitamin C and the vitamin E were 78% less likely to get Alzheimer's disease than the ones that just got the sugar. You reduce your risk of Alzheimer's disease by 80% by just taking two of the mighty 90, vitamin C and vitamin E. What if you take all 90 and avoid the fried foods and eat your 10 eggs a day? The odds of you getting Alzheimer's disease is zero. And please, please, please don't say, well, that sounds kind of interesting. I'm going to ask my doctor. You mean the person who's going to live to be 56? Ooh, ouch. Okay, next. Look at that. Just eating good fish like salmon twice a week reduce your risk of Alzheimer's disease because you're going to get two of the 90 essential nutrients, the omega-3s and omega-6s, right, in the right ratios. Next. Big study in New York. Gosh, just eating a healthy diet reduces your risk of Alzheimer's disease. That sound like a genetic disease to you? No, cannot be. It's impossible to be genetic with articles like that. Study on 2,000 people from New York. Next. Okay, and so we already know how to avoid Alzheimer's disease. There's actually four dementias. There's senile dementia, which is now called vascular dementia because there's nothing wrong with the brain. The arteries are clogged. And then there is Korsakoff syndrome, which I can cure that in 2 weeks. I don't care because it looks like Alzheimer's disease, but it's actually a symptom of a thiamine, vitamin B1 deficiency. People eating lots of sugar and no thiamine. And it looks like Alzheimer's disease, but you just get rid of the sugar and you give them the Mighty 90 and it goes away in 2 weeks. It's a miracle. Then there's Wernicke-Korsakoff's disease, where it's actually MS, multiple sclerosis, and Korsakoff syndrome. That's easy to take care of. And then, of course, there's Alzheimer's disease. So I like to nutritionally treat them and prevent them by giving everything that would cover all four. Don't try and cherry pick one. Well, I'm going to prevent Alzheimer's disease. You get the other three, right? So you don't cherry pick it. Okay, next. Well, let's see. Oh, CT scan. Oh, we're going to cancer. I apologize. You've got to back up. I apologize. There we go. Cancer, big thing. Big thing, cancer, right? That's pretty scary. But you can prevent cancer 100% by, again, avoiding the bad things. Prevention is always easier. It's kind of like putting oil in your car before the engine burns up. You put oil in your car before the engine burns up. You don't wait until the engine burns up and say, well, let's put a little oil in there. Don't get all crazy about trying to get healed when you can prevent it. It's real simple, okay? Much cheaper, much less painful, and you'll add 25 healthier years to your life. Okay, next. CAT scans, which doctors will tell you are harmless, actually have 400% more radiation than they used to think you had. 29,000 new cancer patients every year, of which half, 14,500, die after just one CAT scan. You know, you can get an ultrasound, a high-definition ultrasound for $50, tell you the same information. They can see the valves in the pea-sized heart of a little embryo, human embryo that's just a month old. That high-definition ultrasound, there's no radiation to it, no risk, costs $50. That CAT scan cost $4,000. Next. High-fiber diets do not cut colon cancer risk. That's another old myth. High-fiber diets do not cut colon cancer risk. This was a study on 90,000 nurses and 50,000 male doctors over a 20-year period, the Harvard Nurses' Health Study. There was no problem. I mean, just high-fiber diets didn't help. Got the same rate of cancer from high-fiber diets to low-fiber diets. But when you ate a high-fiber diet because of the risk of celiac disease, because fiber is usually wheat gluten or oat bran or something like that, it increases your risk of diabetes and heart disease and stroke and other stuff.
Don't eat high fiber diets. There is no benefit.
In fact, there's unintended consequences that are not nice. Okay, next. Look at that. Fat doesn't increase your risk of breast cancer. You can actually eat 90% of your calories from fat as long as you don't fry it. Next. This was another study, only 15 years, I think, a study of 15 years, Harvard Nurses' Health Study, 90,000 nurses. You take a high-end multivitamin like our Mighty 90, not a one-a-day Centrum or something like that. It won't work because it only has like 32. It's the Mighty 32 instead of the Mighty 90. You take the Mighty 90, this reduces your risk of colon cancer by 75%. Are there any drugs that will do that? No. Next. Let's see here. Study finds very well done meat linked to breast cancer. You can reduce your risk of breast cancer, ladies, by 462% by eating your meat cooked medium or medium rare. If you cook your meat very well done, where it's burnt, where the fat is burnt, tastes good, but it's a killer. And the devil comes in many guises, including burnt fat. I mean, think about it. You know, hell, fire, and burnt. And I mean, that's the devil's sense of humor there. Okay, next. We've known about selenium being able to prevent and cure certain types of cancer since 1912. Since 1912, we've known this, and I had to sue the FDA. I sued the FDA and won in federal court. They appealed, and I beat them in the appellate court, and then they appealed, and they signed off on the steps of the U.S. Supreme Court for me to be able to say that the trace mineral selenium can prevent certain types of cancer. The trace mineral selenium can help your body make certain anti-cancer substances. Just to say those simple things, I had to sue them three times in federal courts. But the truth won out there in that case. We were able to beat the FDA to death on that one. Thank you. Okay, next. This is just another thing on selenium. It's a big study out of the University of Arizona. Just taking 200 micrograms of selenium, 1/5 of a milligram of selenium, it'll reduce your risk of prostate cancer in men by 69%, colorectal cancer in both genders by 64%, lung cancer, whether you smoke or not, by 39%. Anybody who smokes and doesn't take the Mighty 90 with a little extra selenium is foolish, aren't they? Now, I can guarantee you, ladies, if you take the Mighty 90, you will never get prostate cancer. I can guarantee you that. Okay, next. Next. I love this one. Arsenic can prevent and cure certain types of leukemia. Arsenic, we've known it's an essential nutrient necessary to prevent certain types of cancer, certain types of leukemia since 1947. Isn't that funny? Okay, next. Okay, preventing cancer is very easy. Once you get it, it's a full-time job to treat it as a chronic disease, and you can add 5 or 10 or 15 or 20 or 30 years to your life when you have cancer, but you're going to be working 24/7 for the rest of your life. It's much better to prevent it. That way you have a life, right? It's much better to prevent it, but we can work with you if you do have it. You're salvageable through God's grace. Okay, next. Oh, got to back up one. I'm sorry. Okay, diabetes. 1/3 of Americans have diabetes. It's higher in the black community and the Hispanic community. It's the least in the Asian community, okay? Diabetes is a simple mineral deficiency disease. It's not genetic. Type 2 diabetes makes up 98% of the diabetic population in America. It's a simple mineral deficiency disease. We've known this since 1957. We've known this since 1957. That it's a simple mineral deficiency disease. Now I take the Mighty 90 and I take what we call the Sweeties, which is the trace minerals necessary to support and promote, I can legally say, support and promote healthy carbohydrate and sugar metabolism at the cellular level, support and promote healthy blood sugar levels. We've already established that micromanaging blood pressure doesn't save you from being killed by high blood pressure, and micromanaging your blood sugar doesn't save you from being killed by diabetes, because high blood sugar is just a symptom of diabetes. It's not diabetes. You have to fix the cell walls, okay? Next. Next. Okay. That little red thing on the right side is supposed to represent a what's called a receptor site on the cell wall. Every cell in your body, the trillions and trillions of cells you have in your body, all have receptor sites that are sensitive to insulin. Now, if you don't have these trace minerals, those receptor sites are not sensitive to insulin. Most people who are type 2 diabetics have as much as 10 times more insulin than a normal person. It's not that they lack insulin, it's why they're giving them more insulin. They're trying to override that system. Oftentimes, doctors will tell you you have insulin-resistant diabetes because they are being honest with you. They're telling you, you got plenty of insulin, you're just resistant to it. So the nice thing about this, you take the Mighty 90, you take the Sweeties, which has all these trace minerals, and what happens is you'll resensitize those receptor sites. You got to watch it, though, because your blood sugar will drop, right? And so you have to take your blood sugar every morning, as you've been empowered to do by your doctor. And you've also been empowered to adjust your medication. You do it, you cheat all the time. I'll just have that piece of pecan pie, a little bit of ice cream on it. I'll just take more of my medicine. And, you know, you learn. But the A1C hemoglobin gives you away. You know, you go to the doctor, oh, yeah, my blood sugar is 90 this morning, but your A1C is 14 instead of 5.2. You know, you've been naughty. And so you got to watch it. So you take your blood sugar every morning, and as your blood sugar begins to drop, and it will very rapidly, sometimes in 24 hours, I've seen it drop 90 points in 24 hours. You can't take the same amount of insulin. You got to take, be faithful. Take your blood sugar, adjust your medication as you've been empowered to do. And when you wean off of your medication, you can go back to a normal life. But you have to stay on the Mighty 90, and you have to stay on the extra Sweeties. It just goes away. What kind of a fun way to add 25 healthful years to your life. Next. That's what the sugar metabolism looks like once the sugar gets inside your cell. Now, none of that happens if you don't have these trace minerals to sensitize that receptor site. Next. This is what doctors do for diabetes, Avandia. Killed 100,000 people last year, but it's been approved by the FDA. So you have your choice, the Mighty 90 and Sweeties, or Avandia. Now, your doctor will be just overjoyed to prescribe Avandia to you, but you start talking to him about the Mighty 90 and the Sweeties, and say, oh, that Wallach, you know, he's one of them quack, 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 duck kind of people. Okay, next. Lifestyle approach for type 2 diabetes and metabolic syndrome. Next. Okay, next, you've read that. Oh, this is a big study on 44,000 black women. Drinking juice causes more diabetes than drinking soda pop. Drinking soda pop increases your risk by 27% of diabetes. Drinking juice brings it up by 31%. Now, that doesn't cause it, but these women were all deficient in these trace minerals. And taking in the sugar just sped up the process, made it happen quicker. Next. Okay. So you know what to do for diabetes. You stay away from all the, still, you got to stay away from all the bad stuff, right? No fried foods, no processed meats. You got to stay away from sugar. You got to take in the Mighty 90 plus the Sweeties. Do your due diligence, take your blood sugar every morning, adjust your medication appropriately as you've been empowered to do, and shazam, thank you, Lord, it's gone. Here's a good time. Let's say on three, thank you, Lord, on three. One, two, three. Thank you, Lord! Oh, I love that. Oh, okay. Now, arthritis is a simple mineral deficiency disease. We learned how to prevent and cure arthritis 300 years ago. We learned how to prevent and cure. But I have bone-to-bone arthritis, Dr. Wallach. I don't care if it's bone-to-bone arthritis. I don't care if you've had that for 20 years and you're in such pain now, no medication works to help the pain. Doctors have talked you into double knee replacement and you're scheduled tomorrow. You call them up and say, I'm going to delay it until after January because I'm going to try this Doc Wallach Mighty 90 stuff. Give it 90 days and see what happens, even if you have bone-to-bone arthritis. Even if they have surgically removed your meniscus, we can rebuild it. Praise God. We do it for athletes all the time. We do it for people in the military all the time. We do it to regular people like you and me thousands of times a month. Thousands of times a month. Next. There's going to be an epidemic of arthritis in America here. Why is that? Because there's 80 million baby boomers coming along and they have 72 joints, 10 toes, 2 ankles, 2 knees, 2 hips, 33 vertebrae. 2 shoulders, 2 elbows, 2 wrists, and 10 fingers. And every orthopedic surgeon is running up and down the aisles of church and saying, hallelujah, thank you, Lord. There's 80 million babies coming, baby boomers come along, they have 72 joints, and I'm going to replace them all. But all you have to do is take the Mighty 90 and stay away from the bad stuff. You'll never get arthritis. I'm 71 years old. Okay? And if this was a harder surface, I could stand here on 1 foot because I got a lot of padding up here. I could stand 1 foot for 3 hours and give the lecture. You'll see in a minute. You'll see why. Okay, next. Bell's palsy still baffles doctors. For 200 years, they've been doing research trying to figure it out. We've known for 300 years what causes. Just a manifestation of osteoporosis of your skull bone, squeezing the 7th cranial nerve. You treat it nutritionally as osteoporosis, it goes away. Just that simple. Next. Let's see. Okay, who told you to give up sunlight? Who told you not to take vitamins and minerals? You could get everything from your food. See, a vitamin D3 deficiency, which every doctor is now is taking blood tests to see what your vitamin D3 level is, that's another physician-caused disease. Nobody in a third world country has vitamin D3 deficiency. It's an American disease caused by dermatologists. Okay, next. Even non-cola drinks like 7-Up and stuff like that, Dr. Pepper, those kind of things, Pepsi-Cola, Coca-Cola, you don't want to be drinking carbonated drinks during meals because they will actually neutralize your stomach acid so you cannot absorb minerals or digest proteins or absorb B12. Next. That's medical. See, the medical industry, their answer to arthritis is pain relief and surgically changing your knees out and your hips and your elbows and shoulders and fingers, right? Why not regrow your own? Does God have arthritis? No. Did Jesus have, he was a carpenter. Did he have arthritis? No. And you and I are built in the image of God because the Bible tells us so, right? So if God didn't have arthritis and cancer and heart disease and diabetes and hemorrhoids, why should we? Okay, hallelujah. Okay, next. Okay, oh. That Vioxx, that painkiller, it was the best painkiller ever invented, but it had a little side effect. It killed 85,000 people. Okay, next. Fosamax and Boniva, shame on you, Sally Field. It actually causes fractures. Next. Okay, let's see here. Look at that. No, knee surgery for arthritis is useless, worthless. That's from Harvard Medical School, published in the New England Journal of Medicine. Next. Well, this guy was the president of McDonald's Corporation, had for 7 years in a row had double arthroscopic surgeries every year so he could play golf. And the seventh year, he actually had a double knee replacement because he got weary of those procedures. He was in such pain he had to take OxyContin, couldn't do his job properly, and they fired him. The board fired him from a $100 million a year job because he had a double knee replacement. And of course, every time he tries to call the orthopedic surgeon who did that to him, the surgeon looks at him and says, oh, that's Ralph, we're not gonna answer his phone. Okay, next. Okay, back surgery is unnecessary. We can support and promote healthy maintenance and repair, which means we can regrow your disc. Why would you have surgery when you can regrow your own disc with a little bit of supplements? Well, my doctor said, you mean the one who lives to be 56? Next. Men and women get osteoporosis, not a postmenopausal woman's disease. Next. This is just 2010. Okay, men and women both get osteoporosis. Next. You know how Cleopatra got her calcium? It was kind of a peasant's thing to get it from limestone and oyster shells. So she put pearls in vinegar and drank that vinegar pearl mix every day. $5,000 a day for calcium supplements. We get ours a lot cheaper. Okay, next. Those top two are the ones, the middle two, the Healthy Starter Pack and the Liquid Classic. We'll talk about that next. We want to think of the Mighty 90, and then every time you have a disease, you want to take something special for that disease. That's why we have the flower concept. Next, 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 next. Okay, that's me. That's my bone density test. You can see me up there at 5.5. I'm up there with 18-year-old male athletes, and I'm 71 years old, and that's because I've been doing the Mighty 90 since I was 9. Been doing the Mighty 90 since... for 62 years. Thank you. Thank you. My blood pressure is 121 over 71. I've never been on a prescription medication. My resting pulse is 43. My resting pulse is 43. Huh? Now, if I were to go to a cardiologist, he'd want to give me a pacemaker. He'd want to put me on medication. He'd want to give me a heart transplant. But I'll bet I can outlast him in a fight, okay? I just have to dodge him for 56 years. Okay, next. Okay, I'm just going to briefly say a couple of things about obesity here, and then we're going to open this up for questions for a few moments. Obesity is a disease of deficiency. It's not a disease of excess. Obesity is not a disease of excess. Obesity is not a disease of excess. That's why nobody's been able to solve the problem. Because everybody views it as a disease of excess. It's a deficiency disease. The symptom of the deficiency disease, these special minerals, the minerals deficiencies cause a special symptom called the munchies. And so instead of giving you these minerals, medical doctors invented the snack food industry. That's the treatment for the munchies, is snack foods. Next. So, Hell's Kitchen is the book for diabetes, for obesity, for the metabolic syndrome. We got plenty of those out there. Hell's Kitchen, you know, we call it a Hell's Kitchen because a kitchen in your home can be a place of heaven or a place of hell, depending on how you cook. I mean, you can kill somebody, you can purposely murder them. All you got to do is give them out with everything, eat fried foods for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. You'll walk. Okay, next. The paleo diet, which is just essentially meat and vegetables, no grains. Well, wait a minute! Doctors say the whole grains are good. You mean the ones that live to be 56? Okay, go on. Next. Oh, that tells a story. Next. 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 Oh, yeah, look at that. Next. Look at that. Next. 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 Okay. Patrick Duell weighed 1,072 pounds. They gave him a stomach bypass. They put him on a calorie-restricted diet, and he lost 462 pounds over a two-year period. And this is him leaving the hospital to go home. When he got home, he died. Bam! He just drops dead. Because when you're obese, fat is not the disease. Fat is just a symptom of the disease. Just like when you have diabetes, high blood sugar is a symptom of the disease. When you have high blood pressure is just a symptom of the disease. Being overweight and obese is just a symptom of the disease, which is a mineral deficiency. The mineral deficiency will still kill you. You all know somebody who's lost 50 pounds, 100 pounds. Well, Francine did such a good job, she lost all that weight, and then she went and died. Next. This gal here, she had two Guinness World Book of Records. Rosalie Bradford, she had two Guinness World Book of Records. Very famous lady. Number one, her first Guinness World Book of Records, she was the heaviest woman ever weighed. She weighed 1,200 pounds officially by Guinness World Book of Records. You went on two dates with Rosalie, you had a ton and a quarter of fun. And then her second Guinness World Book record, she officially lost 736 pounds. And then she died because the doctors failed to understand that the weight was not the problem, it was just the symptom of the disease. Okay, are you getting it now? Okay, the Mighty 90 will prevent you from being overweight. If you're overweight, you take the Mighty 90 and then you throw in what we call the Slender FX weight management program to it. And the weight just goes away healthily. You stay on those things, you never gain the weight back, and you'll add 25 to 50 healthful years of your life. It's that simple. Okay, next. Next, next, next. Oh, back up one. 44% of our kids under the age of 15 of all races look like that today. That's because they are minerally deficient. It has nothing to do with too many video games or too much television or too much texting and all that kind of stuff. Is a mineral deficiency disease. Next. Next. See, everybody wants to think this is a cause of obesity. This is the symptom of the cause of obesity. It's not the cause of obesity. It's the symptom of the cause of obesity. Next. This young fellow here from South Carolina, 14 years old, weighed 555 pounds. They put the mother in jail. And they took him away from the mother. They should have put the pediatrician in jail because she went to him every year saying, my kid's 200 pounds overweight, my kid's 300 pounds overweight. She kept going to the pediatrician. He said, make him exercise. They should have put the pediatrician in jail, not the mother. Okay, next. Loyola University in Chicago came out in August of 2009 and said, exercise won't help you lose weight. In fact, it makes you hungrier because when you sweat, From exercising, you're not losing just water, but a soup that contains all these minerals. And when you lose all these minerals, you just get hungrier. Okay. So now you take that money, but you have to take it appropriate for body weight. Somebody who weighs 100 pounds will take one-third the amount of somebody who takes 300 pounds, because it goes one dose per 100 pounds of body weight. Okay, it's by body weight. You always come to me and say, well, I've been taking it for 14 months and nothing's happening. Okay, we weigh 200 pounds. How much are you taking? Well, I take a thimbleful faithfully every day. Okay, well, that won't work, okay? Okay, now I've covered a lot of territory. I have a few minutes left here. We don't want to run into your time, so I'm going to take a couple of questions. That gentleman in the gray here in the mustache way in the back, he put up his hand first. Yes, sir.
About the age of 20,
Okay, that's enough. Okay, I get the picture. What? I have to ask you. I have to ask you one question. Was the kid born apparently normal? Yes or no? Okay, no, it's too complicated. You'll have to come to the side with me. The lady in the orange there, you, the long hair, ponytail. Yes, ma'am.
All my life, well, my father had PKD. All his sisters had PKD. His mother had PKD. And they said it's genetic disease.
No! PAD, peripheral artery disease, causing high blood pressure, is not genetic. PAD is not genetic. PAD is not genetic.
PKD, polycystic kidney disease.
Oh, polycystic kidney disease is not genetic. It's not genetic.
Thank
PKD.
You.
PKD, polycystic kidney disease is caused by malnutrition of the embryo in the first couple of days of pregnancy. Now, were all these people breastfed? Yes? Yeah. Okay, now the mother, growing up, was as a newborn baby, was breastfed, and so she developed celiac disease, probably. Does the mother of these children, did they, all the way back, did they have skin problems like eczema, dermatitis? Your dad, yeah, what about the mother's? Okay, you have to ask that question. Did they have things like asthma? Anybody have respiratory stuff? Did the kids with the polycystic kidney disease have asthma or dermatitis or eczema? Eczema, okay, then they all have celiac disease. Now, they'll never fix that, but it's not a genetic thing. It's all caused by having celiac disease. So everybody's got to get on a wheat, barley, rye, and oat-free diet, and they need to be taking the Mighty 90, and the next generation of kids will not be born with PKD, polycystic kidney disease. Okay, gentleman over there in the black shirt, yeah. Okay, just have to wait a second so we can get the... Doesn't anybody have arthritis? Okay. Yeah.
We recommend that people start on the Mighty 90 disease, but previous to that, would you also recommend people detoxing before they start any new regimen?
Okay, he's asking, should people start detoxing? Well, it depends. If somebody's on 14 medications and they got 12 different diseases, I would not detox them first, okay, because it's too complicated. When you put somebody on a detox who's on all these medications, they have all these diseases, you're going to get some kind of problem. They're going to run to the hospital and it'll be a mess. So what you want to do when somebody's on all these medications and have multiple diseases, you do not want to put them on a detox at that point. You want to get them on the Mighty 90, which will not interfere with any medications, and you get them off of gluten when they have, you know, multiples of diseases, no wheat, barley, rye, and oats, and then one by one we can deal with each medication separately. But that's a complicated thing, but it's doable. Yes, ma'am, right here.
The book Eat Right for Your Blood Type. Are you familiar with that?
I'm very familiar with it. I know Peter Diadamo very well.
Okay, so what is your opinion?
Okay, the thing that's brilliant about that book, in every case, it's every diet is a non-gluten diet. It's a gluten-free diet, essentially. No gluten. The book supports that. Yes, sir.
You mentioned last night Italians and olive oil
yeah.
was bad. What do you suggest for cooking oil?
Okay, what do I suggest for cooking oil? No cooking oils. What you want to do is cook in water and butter. People have been cooking water and butter for thousands of years. It's only been in the last 50 years that everybody's told you to cook in olive oil and, okay? Goat butter, cow's butter, dog butter, moose butter, camel butter, it doesn't matter. Butter's butter.
Grass-fed?
It doesn't
cows,
matter.
Doesn't matter?
Doesn't matter. This gentleman right here.
What causes food allergies?
What causes food allergies? Usually, food allergies are caused by malabsorption or maldigestion, where you don't break proteins up into the individual amino acids, and relatively large chunks of protein called polypeptides, maybe 20 to 100 amino acids still hooked together, absorbed. Your body recognizes them as some outside entity. You build up antibodies to those, and every time you eat that food, you get an allergy. If your digestion is perfect, you'll never get a food allergy. So you need to work on your digestion when you have a food allergy.
Would that be related to eczema?
Yes, eczema. If you have eczema, you've got celiac disease. You got to get off of wheat, barley, rye, and oats, take the Mighty 90, and it'll all go away. Yes, ma'am, right there. Eczema is the giveaway.
Yep. My mother has Alzheimer's. Is there anything that she can do to reverse that?
Okay, is this individual in a nursing home?
Yes.
There's nothing we can do because they won't let you do anything.
I mean, I can take her out, so.
Well, you can take her out, yeah, okay.
Oh, yeah.
Well, here's the secret. What you want to do is try a few things, right? Mm-hmm. Can you take her out to eat? I mean, can you take her out for kind of like a furlough? Yeah, well, you want to take her out and give her some of this stuff and let her eat 4 or 5 eggs, soft scrambler in butter. And give her the Mighty 90 and do that once a week or twice a week if you can. And then see if there's a little bit of improvement, then it's worth going the next step, getting her out of there. This lady here in the checker outfit there, yeah.
Will the Mighty 90 help with acid reflux?
Oh, absolutely. Acid reflux is very common today. Just about everybody's got acid reflux and belching and burping and heartburn and, you know, that kind of stuff. And this is actually just the opposite of what a doctor will tell you. He'll say, oh, you got to get on a proton pump inhibitor like Zantac and Prilosec and what is it, the purple pill, right? So you can stop the acid production, get on antacids. Well, guess what? When you have reflux and heartburn and belching and burping and bloating and gas out the other end, that's caused by not enough stomach acid. We actually have stomach acid. You can pump stomach acid down there. It just works like a charm. It all goes away. Now, for first aid, what you want to do is use what's called peppermint oil. How many of you ever heard of peppermint oil? Yeah. We actually have some here through the World Changers Church. You put a little peppermint oil and 8 ounces of hot water, sip on that instead of tea, it'll go away in 2 minutes. Okay, yeah, back there, because you're back there, okay.
Yeah, I was wondering about...
Okay, we'll come over there, okay.
If you get your colon cleansed, do you recommend that? Because the lady was saying you can get Alzheimer's when you're not clean inside.
Okay. A colon cleanse is not going to cure somebody of Alzheimer's disease, but we have a 5-day colon cleanse. We have an every night colon cleanse. We have blood cleanses. We have liver cleanses. We love cleanses. But it's not going to fix Alzheimer's disease. Okay. And he's coming around there. Okay. Let him come to you with the... I'm assuming you're a representative for all those ladies jumping up and down. Yes, ma'am.
About 10 years ago, I was diagnosed with fibromyalgia, and I've had muscle spasms and so forth and all kinds of other symptoms, but I wanted to know what you recommend for that.
Okay. Fibromyalgia is actually a very simple disease. It's related to diseases like lupus. Okay, lupus and fibromyalgia are very simple. Muscular dystrophy, they're all kind of related. And what you want to do is get on a gluten-free diet. You get on, and this will be forever. You can never go back, right? A gluten-free diet. Get on the Mighty 90, take some extra selenium, and it'll just go away. We eliminated that in animals in 1957. Fibromyalgia is called white muscle disease in animals because muscle actually turns into scar tissue. But we can repair that and bring it all back. And the reason why we discovered it so quickly in animals is because muscle is meat. Anything that damages the meat industry and the agriculture industry, they fix in 2 weeks. In human beings, The pharmaceutical industry loves it when they treat you for 40 years and 40 nights, right?
Thank you.
Okay. Yes, right here. Lady in red.
What causes glaucoma?
Okay, glaucoma is PAD, peripheral artery disease of the eye, causes blood pressure to go up in the eye. And so what you would do is you would actually approach that nutritionally as you would high blood pressure. You take the Mighty 90, you take the, what we call those daily tablets, and they're designed to, I can legally say, support and promote healthy blood flow through those microscopic arteries in the eye. The eye pressure comes right down. But you have to stay away from fried foods and processed meats, deli slices, sausage, ham, bacon, bologna, salami, pastrami, pepperoni, and jerky. All of those things damage those little arteries and cause the blood pressure to go up. You've all heard of PAD in the toes and the fingers and so, and in the eyes and the heart muscle and so on, the kidneys. In fact, PAD of the kidneys causes kidney failure. When you have, how many of you heard of kidney failure? Raise your hand. Okay, good. It's oftentimes a complication of high blood pressure and also of diabetes. And when you have kidney failure and you're on dialysis, there's nothing wrong with your kidneys. I repeat that. When you have kidney failure, there's nothing wrong with your kidneys. When you have kidney failure, you have PAD, those little microscopic arteries that feed the dirty blood into the filtering units. And we figured out a way to support and promote, I can legally say, support and promote healthy blood flow through that little microscopic artery, taking the dirty blood into the filtering units. And lo and behold, people with 5% or 10% kidney function, and within a couple of months, it goes to 100% and they're off of dialysis. And they get to keep their God-given kidney. Whew, hallelujah.
What can be done? What can be done to treat sleep apnea?
Okay, what can be done to treat sleep apnea? I love that one. Sleep apnea is a normal sleep cycle. Here's a case where doctors have turned a normal sleep cycle into a disease. Have you ever watched a baby sleep? It'll breathe for maybe 5 minutes or so, and then it'll stop breathing for a moment. After about 30 seconds, it goes, she knew exactly what was going to happen. You take a deep breath, and because what happens is the stimulus to breathe is caused by carbon dioxide levels of your blood. When you're laying there asleep and you're breathing properly, you blow off all the carbon dioxide in your blood. You're not generating any because you're sleeping, and you stop breathing for 30 seconds. And then when you build up enough carbon dioxide, you start breathing again. You see this in kids and puppies and adults. Sleep apnea is a normal sleep cycle. Now, let me tell you, you wouldn't even know you had it. It usually bothers your sleeping partner. And so, you know, the way that grandpa used to solve the problem was they'd sleep in separate bedrooms, right? You ever wonder why grandma and grandpa would sleep in separate bedrooms? Because one of them was snoring, they're both snoring, out of sync, and when they wanted to get frisky, they put a blue thumbtack on the door above the eye level of the kids. And they knew what that blue thumbtack meant, but... Okay, we got time for one more, I think. Okay, but I'm going to be available. Yes.
Does the Mighty 90 help you with fibroids or anything like that?
Oh, okay. Fibroids are okay. That's a good one to finish on. Uterine fibroids or fibroid tumors, quote unquote, is actually fibromyalgia of the smooth muscle of the uterus, and it's caused by eating fried foods and processed meats. You got to get off of fried foods and processed meats. You take the Mighty 90. And you got to stay away from salad dressings and mayonnaise, anything with oxidized oils in it, okay? And then you get on the Mighty 90 and throw in some extra selenium. Take 4, 5, or 6 of those capsules a day, and it'll just go away. It'll be a miracle.
And one more question. You mentioned something about not frying eggs, and I stopped eating eggs on a regular for a long time. How should I say, you can eat eggs a little fried, but it still be healthy for you?
You cannot eat eggs fried that are still healthy for you.
With butter?
Okay. Well, you eat them soft-boiled, or, and listen to the words here, soft-boiled, soft-poached, or soft-scrambling butter, and they have to be soft for you to be able to keep that cholesterol normal, because you want that cholesterol for the brain, for hormones. Ladies, one of the secrets for getting through menopause is to eat 6 to 10 eggs a day, because you're going to make estrogen and progesterone. If you're on a cholesterol-restricted diet, you're giving up eggs and red meat, and you're eating tofu and all that kind of stuff, and cutting the fat off your meat, and eating margarine instead of butter, and cooking stuff in oils instead of lard, guess what? You're going to be miserable for 30 years with menopause. Our grandmothers went through menopause in 3 seconds because They were eating eggs. Pastor, I see you there.
You know, what we're going to do, because I know y'all have a lot of questions. Here's what we're going to do. This is so cool of Doc to do this. Saturday morning from 11 o'clock to 2, he's going to be our guest in the Body Sculpting Center. All right, listen. You'll not only be able to come and talk to Dr. Wallach, but we've called all of his products to be sent here at the same time. Okay? So, on Saturday from 11 o'clock and 2, you can stop by. You can get that Power 90. You can get some advice on how to use some of the stuff. And we got a pallet of the stuff coming in. Isn't that cool of him to stay here and to be able to do that for us? Now, see, everybody was telling me not to eat my eggs. And I knew it wasn't the Holy Ghost. I wasn't going to stop. I rebelled against it, you know. And I'm telling you, man, 11 o'clock Saturday. I mean, this is an opportunity. I mean, he does 300 of these a year. We're blessed to have him here with us this time. This is something that we feel is vital for Christian people, that you continue to learn, you continue to learn. But I want to make sure you heard something in these last couple of days. You have to be responsible for giving your body Amen. What it needs in order to operate. If you give your body what it needs in order to operate, your body will take care of you. But if you challenge your body with stuff that's gonna, you know, hinder its operation and then not give it the necessary tools in order to fight and do what it needs to do, it's real simple. Living a healthy life is not complicated. I mean, it's so simple, but you got to follow the instructions. You've got to watch those nitrates, which a lot of folks don't even know about. We love sandwich meat and give me a hot dog and all that other kind of stuff. That stuff will kill you. And even turkey bacon. You've got to watch out for the turkey. You think that's a healthy alternative, but I think it has nitrates in it.
Yes, it doesn't matter if it's turkey bacon, turkey slices from the deli, or turkey sausage. It's all bad.
Yeah, it's all bad. And look at y'all like, oh, you just messing
what?
With turkey bacon. What?
See, because they were told because it's low fat that it's good, but it's still got the nitrates.
Yeah.
There are some that there are, you have to, big letters, no nitrates, that's okay.
Yeah. All right, so how about that, Saturday? So how many of you have questions? Now tonight at the table, if you didn't get a hold of, this is information that not only gives you information about all of the different packs, but on the back it gives some more information. You've got phone numbers, you've got
websites.
We're trying to equip you so that you can achieve this. It's, you know, it would be so cool, Minister Lahr, that we didn't have no funerals for like
Amen.
6 months. You know, I mean,
what about
none.
60 years?
60,
Amen.
Well, 60 years would 60 be great.
Years, Amen.
Of course, we'd have to reassign you somewhere. That 60 years would be great. But it's just too many people dying at young ages. This has just got to stop. And we can lead the way, and we can accept the challenge. And it doesn't have to be difficult. It doesn't have to be hard. Doc, that's the guy that cooks for me right there. The guy that asked you, he's an Italian. He asked you about the olive oil because he's Italian.
Oh, okay.
And
well, we still love him.
Well, we love him. Yeah. but he's been able to put a diet together for us where we can eat, enjoy what we eat. We maintain weight. We're not really struggling. It's not like a diet. We're just eating all the right stuff. And how about that good steak?
Oh. Hoo-ah!
For all you people who want to just be vegetarians, how about that good steak? How about that brain needing that cholesterol up there from get? Come on now, how about them eggs? Yeah, how about that butter? Shut up now. But you know what? I can see y'all now. I can see y'all now. I can see you right now. I'm gonna do that power 90, man. I'm finna go and get this honey bun. And you can't. The power 90 is not gonna be the thing that's gonna cancel out you making the wrong decisions to put the wrong stuff on the inside of you. So there're gonna have to be some decisions you make. You got to discipline yourself to stay away from some of the stuff. And life can be good. You can enjoy yourself. And you know, I just, you know, something must have been wrong with this. All I need, you know, all you're supposed to eat is beans. You know, I just don't believe that. And the Bible said, eat meat. I'm just going to stick with the word, eat meat. I ain't just got to just eat beans and beans. I'd be so tired of eating if I just had to eat beans all the time. Beans, 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 eating goobers, beans. No, it doesn't have to be like that. And the good doctor has made it very clear to us, we've got to understand what the body needs, give it what it needs, stay away from the things that it doesn't need, and life should be good. We should all be living up to 70 and 80 without having all of our hair turn white. Cool? Would you please give Doc, now I don't know if he's gonna be at the table or not, but I mean, you know, between tonight and Saturday, if you see him, give him a big thanks and let him know how much we enjoyed him and how much we want him to keep coming back and being a part of what we got on here.
Thank you.
It's just really, really good. I mean, did you really enjoy him? He really brought a lot of balance and sense to what's going on. And you know, we were, amen. We wanted to be very prayerful about the person that would fill this slot to talk to us about healthy living. Because you can go way to the right, you can go way to the left, you can leave pretty emotionally distraught. But I love this man's balance. And he's, like I say, what I love about it is he's 71. And he's been using it since 9.
Since 9, yes.
So that's a whole lot different than some dude who's, you know, 47 telling you what you need to be taking. 71 good. 71 good, and he's healthy, and 300 of these are done a year. A 71-year-old doing 300 meetings a year, and he's doing it like he's 22. Come on, somebody. You know, here's one thing I'm not gonna forget. I got this. Boom, dead. I'm like, wow. Bam, fell dead, you know. Wow, it kind of got your attention, like, whoa. You know, would you please give him a big hand clap? Doc, thank you so much.
Thank you,
Pastor. Certainly appreciate it.
I'll see you in the back.
Praise God. You want to sow into this tonight?
Yeah.
Let's sit down and sow a seed into this tonight. And man, I'm excited about the decisions you'll make. Excited about the decisions you make. Soft scrambled eggs and butter. That's how I cook it, man. Absolutely. Yes, amen. That's what I'm talking about, boy. It's my man right there, boy. That's what I'm talking about, boy. Nice steak. Tender, grass-fed, baby. Yeah, yeah. Shoot, I was talking about, yeah. Beans and rice. That ain't the Lord. That's all that stuff. The Lord talking about abundant life. Amen. Now, we've got a lot of neat things going on, and we want you guys to be a part of it. I'll take the opportunity to announce this. We will start registration in I think either the last part of October, November, for the official opening of our Bible school and our med school. That'll be a 2-year program. And And I am so excited about it. I was so thrilled about it because there are people that are graced to do things, and we need to help them to get to the place where God wants them to be. And so we will, it won't be on the web the first session, but after 2012, it'll be made available to the entire world. You can do it on the Take School on the web, or you can come and go through the classes and stuff. But we're excited about it. We want to make sure that it is something that when you go through it, you'll be prepared to do anything. Amen. You'll be prepared for anything. So I'm excited about it and just stirred up about it. And you'll hear more information about that as we make progress with it to give you some official dates and everything. And it'll be one of those Bible schools where at least you've read the entire Bible and were quizzed on all your reading, so at least you know about it. You'd be surprised at the number of preachers who are preaching in pulpits and never read through the Bible. Don't even do that. You'd be shocked to see that. But it's going to be an amazing thing that we so look forward to as we continue to help you to grow in grace and to do what God's called you to do. Hold your offerings up. Let me get you out of here. Not trying to keep you. Thank y'all so much for coming tonight, man. That's so cool for y'all to be here tonight. It's on a Thursday night, and y'all came back cool, church. Amen. Father, we pray over the offerings tonight. We sow them into the kingdom of God. We thank you for good health and long life. We thank you that we'll live long and we'll live strong. Hallelujah. And we thank you that our body lines up with the word of God. It lines up with perfect health. And we give you praise and glory for it now. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said, amen. Let's just go ahead and receive the offering. We don't ever want to not have the opportunity for you to come down to get born again. So if you're here tonight and you're not born again, but you'd like to make Jesus the Lord, the Savior of your life, if you're here tonight, you want to rededicate your life to the Lord, or if you're here tonight, you want to receive the baptism in the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues, or if you're here tonight and you believe God's calling you to join this church, we'd like for you to take opportunity to do what you believe God wants you to do tonight. And, maybe it wasn't a Bible lesson, but it was certainly a lesson that's going to help us live better lives. And tonight, Jesus Christ is so available and so ready to sit on the throne of your life and to be the Lord and Savior of your life, but you've got to invite him in. So tonight, if you want to become spiritually healthy, let Jesus into your life as your Lord and personal Savior. Tonight, you rededicate your life and say, God, not only am I going to rededicate myself to good health, but I'm going to rededicate myself to living in the Word of God and doing what God has called me to do, to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit or to join this church. We're going to stand in a moment, and if you'd like to respond to any of those things, we welcome you to this altar. I'll be glad and excited to pray for you tonight. So at this time, if you would stand, minister to those who are around you. If they need some help in coming down, help them come down. We'll be glad to minister to them tonight.
Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether worthy, altogether wonderful.
Congregation, don't you appreciate those who come down here? Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Father, we thank you for the mighty hand of God on these precious lives to remove burdens and to destroy yokes. We thank you that they'll never be the same again because of the power of the Holy Ghost operating in them. We thank you that they'll live long and live strong, Father. And we give you praise and that the hand of God be upon them from this night forward. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. At this time, if you follow our deacons to the prayer room, they're going to take you and minister to you and give you biblical understanding of how to obtain and maintain what you came to receive. And you'll never be the same again. Never, 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 never. Praise the Lord. Well, hey, thank you guys so much. I hope you enjoyed this two-day health conference, and I hope it just will be the beginning of something new in your life. Taffy and I love you, and we believe that the best is yet to come. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling. Look at that. He's able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the Almighty God be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever. And everybody said, amen. God bless you. Thank you so much.